call the meeting to order. This is the August 24th Village Council meeting. We have already called the roll because we were in executive session at 6:00. So we'll move first into announcements. Any announcements from council?
I have a few. First of all, I wanted to again mention that we're still taking nominations for the Village Inspiration and Design Award through September 7th. That'll be awarded during the October art stroll. And those can be.
Wait, you said November 7th.
Did I? September 7th. Sorry. Thank you for, yes, until September 7th, it'll be awarded at October art stroll. And those can be emailed to PAC, that stands for the Public Art Commission, @ville.yellowsprings.oh.us. Second thing, I wanted to give a sort of save the date for something that's going to happen here at the John Bryan Center. I think everybody knows because Diane wrote a great article about Patty's three-day 60-mile walk to help end breast cancer. And we're going to do a quarter auction in the gym. There'll be more details about what that is, but it's on October 3rd from 1 to 4 p.m., and it's going to be a lot of fun. And then I wanted to announce something kind of a little bit different. There was a letter to the editor in last Thursday's paper that bothered me a bit, and I wanted to particularly announce that when we are talking about some of these issues that come up with interactions with our police officers and citizens, one of the things that I learned recently is that when the lights are turned on in our police vehicles, that automatically turns on the camera and also the recording device, which reaches out about an eighth of a mile from the police vehicles. So that means that you can basically see and hear everything that happens. And what I also learned is that if it is not a situation that's under investigation, those videos are public record, so anyone can see them. In this particular incident, I watched that video, and I take issue with descriptions that were made about our officers being extremely aggressive. And I think it's important, because we'll be discussing this later in the meeting, that if we are going to continue to make progress, we've got a great chief who has responded to the values that the community has identified as being important, that we need to be mindful of more objective evidence. And so you don't have to believe me in this case, because you can watch the video yourself, but I also watched several other videos in situations where citizens had complained about how the officers had treated them. And in all cases, what I observed was very respectful, calm, cool, collected attitudes from our officers. I was actually very impressed. I did not always see those things from the citizens involved. And so one of the things that's going to be important to me moving forward is to address assumptions that are being made and implications that there is truth out there when you look at the objective evidence like the video, you see something very different. And so I also appreciate that Lauren asked for qualification of assumptions that were made that really don't bear out in the video. But the short announcement is that those are public record, so you can see them for yourself. And I'm actually hoping that the HRC will also help facilitate looking for, I guess, sort of objective evaluations of these situations so that we can actually resolve any problems that we have. So sorry that that was long, but I think it was very important.
Thanks, Brian. Any other announcements? Okay. Oh, sorry. Yeah, they're floating in the air. Thank you.
Lori.
Sorry?
Your mic.
Oh.
Yes.
Yep.
Thank you.
Got it.
We have a consent agenda that includes the minutes of the July 6th regular council meeting, the July 20th work session, the July 20th special council meeting, the August 17th work session, and the financials for July 2015. is someone ready to make a motion to accept them all, or does anybody want to pull any of those out for discussion?
I move that we accept all.
I'll second that.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Now we have a review of the agenda. We have quite a few pieces of legislation. Council, I think if you note that there are some amended documents on our desk for that legislation. We have a special report and things in old business. Anything that needs to be added, anything to be moved around?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, at the last council meeting, I had requested that we have time to hear the Environmental Commission's initial request regarding a Clean Ohio grant. And it did not get on the agenda, but the materials did get in the packet.
Right.
So I guess that would be under new business.
Yeah.
And our purpose at this meeting is just to introduce the concept and very briefly say what we're talking about and get concerns, suggestions.
Okay.
Not for a decision.
Okay, sounds good. Anything else to be changed? Okay. Lori, can you take a moment to review a couple of the, or to review the petitions and communications?
Yeah, there are two from citizens. One from Paul Avendroth regarding a sewer gate, a grate on Rice Road that tends to fill up with debris. And one from Jason Paoletti about site obstruction on the corner of Glen and Corey Streets. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to ask John or somebody, staff, maybe to take a look at that.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to shut my phone down. It's making noise, and I forgot to do that. So my apologies.
So what is staff taking a look at?
Both of those.
Well, and definitely the site obstruction.
Right, that's a big issue,
right.
Chief.
And I believe that there has been contact with staff about the sewer grate right. situation. Moving on to public hearings and legislation, we have first reading of ordinance 2015-08. Let's go ahead and read this in completely.
Okay, this is vacating an alley at the easternmost portion of North College Street. Whereas the village has received a petition from Antioch College Corporation to vacate the right-of-way of an alley along the eastern portion of North College Street. And whereas the Planning Commission of the Village of Yellow Springs has conducted a public hearing on said application in accordance with the Village of Yellow Springs Codified Ordinances, Section 1224.02. And whereas the Planning Commission and Village staff have recommended the approval of the application to vacate the aforementioned alley segment, now, therefore, the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, hereby ordains that. Section 1, the Village does hereby vacate any interest it has or may have had in the subject right-of-way, except that the Village retains for its future prospective use an easement for utilities and related purposes, as well as retains the same for the benefit of public utility companies currently using the easement area for utilities and related purposes. Section 2, the petition to vacate right-of-way of an alley along the eastern portion of North College Street is hereby approved. Section 3, the easement for utilities and related purposes along the eastern portion of North College Street is hereby approved, and the vacated area and easement area are set forth in Attachment 1, which is attached here to and incorporated herein. Section 4, the Clerk of Council shall cause this vacation and easement to be officially recorded at the Greene County Recorder's Office 30 days after the adoption of this ordinance. The village manager is authorized to execute any documents necessary to effect the vacation of the alley and easement as described above.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
This is a planning issue, so I will turn this over to John Young.
So back in April of 2015, this issue was brought before the Planning Commission. This is a vacation of a section of the eastern section of North College Street, located on the map that I provided to you. The portion is 66 feet in width. It's 1,036 feet in length. It has been closed to automobile traffic for some time. However, it does serve as a fire access to existing buildings located along the street. It is located in the Education One Institutional, Educational Institution Zoning District. Section 1224.02B of the Village Code of Ordinances highlights a criteria for right-of-way vacation, which is in your report. The Planning Commission used the requirements as a basis for reviewing the street vacation. In the review, there was some concern about utility easements, and as you can see in the pictures of the site and the plans for what was presented at the Eco Village Charette in March, there will be some buildings along the right-of-way. However, working with the utility department and the college, those issues those concerns were met as part of the utility agreement. The other concern was about emergency vehicle access, which needs to be maintained. The college intends to replace the concrete there with brick pavers. We wanted to ensure that emergency vehicles can get along that, and also that the tree clearances would also allow for fire trucks, which they also agreed to. At that meeting, the Planning Commission did vote to recommend that the Village Council approve the proposed right-of-way vacation with the conditions that they maintain the easement for utility and public access, reach an agreement on utility repair and maintenance, maintain access for fire emergency vehicles, and strengthen access path to support emergency vehicles and maintain a height clearance. With that, do you have any questions about the report?
And because it was obviously supposed to be a road. I mean, that one is relatively clear that, actually both of them were kind of clear that at some point they were supposed to be roads. But so what materials are they able to place in that area? Is there any restriction on the materials that they're allowed to use?
Just make sure that the materials are installed in a way that would be allow a fire truck to drive across it without creating a hazard where the fire truck would destroy the materials. So
it could be asphalt?
Oh, their plan is to put brick down.
But it would have to be strong enough to support the fire vehicle.
Yes.
Was there any desire that it be maintained as brick and not installed as asphalt?
No,
they really wanted it to be brick.
See, it's on them to admit, you know, if they put brick down, it has to be of a such a characteristic that it can support a fire vehicle and it would not crumble and so mm-hmm. forth.
Well, I understand that. It's more a matter of ensuring that it is brick that goes down and not
asphalt.
No, we didn't.
And I think, wasn't there also a restriction, John, that it not be used for parking?
I think there was concern about it being used for parking. But they made it pretty clear that they didn't want it to be parking because of the plan that they had presented at the with the charrette. They really want this to be kind of a pedestrian connector between through campus and then something that also connects to the Little Miami bike trail.
Yeah. And also, if we had to go in there and make repairs to our lines and so forth, we weren't responsible for putting it back to the same condition. Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any other questions? It's a first reading, but we'll hear any questions or comments from citizens on this issue. Seeing and hearing none, we'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Asplund?
Yes.
Pausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next is Ordinance 215-11. We probably don't need to read that all into the record, and then John can just describe the situation.
So I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
Just go ahead and read the ordinance by title only.
All right, this is Ordinance 2015-11, vacating an alley right-of-way along an eastern portion of Hermit Street.
Can I get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, John?
This is a request to vacate the eastern section of Hermit Street from the turnaround to Corey Street. That is 25 feet wide and is 1,022 feet in length. It's a paper street. It is, it was initially heard on December 8th, and then again in April, May, and then June 8th of this year. So we've had a lot of meetings on it. The street is located in the E1 Education Institutional Zoning District. The requirements in the code, they're there. You can read them. Discussion on this over the last few meetings really kind of centered around the location and maintenance of utility easements in the Herman Street right-of-way. We do have a sewer and a sewer manhole that runs underneath the street. We need to access that with our vacuum truck. So after a couple of meetings with Reggie from the college and Nick Budis from the farm, we were able to get that an agreement worked out that would appease all parties, including the village. So with that, we presented that agreement to the Planning Commission on June 8th. They subsequently recommended that Village Council approve the vacation with the conditions that a 16-foot wide easement will be provided on level ground for vacuum truck access. A 16-foot wide gate will be permitted to be installed along the easement that will remain unlocked for utility access. That there should be no farm use within 10 feet of the existing sewer manholes along the easement. And there's only one manhole. And then Public Works will also work with the college to determine the location of the access gate. And that was the conditions that were agreed upon at the June 8th meeting. Do you have any questions?
Could you describe where the manhole is and where the gate will be?
So do you guys have a copy of the map?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The gate will be located at the end of the turnaround to the left. The manhole is really located where that arrow is, where the to-be-vacated box is.
Oh, wow.
And then there's another sewer grate and drainage basin at Corey Street, which is unaffected by this.
So they will need to be leaving that area open, or at least for access?
Yeah, and we identified a pathway that would be level enough for the vacuum truck to actually get through there. So we're working on putting the gate in and then a way to get to the manhole so we can maintain that manhole.
Okay. Any other comments or questions from council? Comments or questions from citizens? Bring it back to council table. Are we ready to vote?
And the other thing to make real clear, that gate will never be locked.
Exactly.
Yep.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So our guys don't have to worry about running around trying to find a key or whatever.
So if we do have like a sewer collapse or some emergency situation, we can get in there and move rather quickly.
Okay. Judy, would you please call the vote?
Yes, Sims.
Yes.
Couch.
Yes.
McQueen.
Yes.
Eskland.
Yeah.
Wintrow.
Yes.
By the way, neither of those, the text of those ordinances wasn't in the electronic packet.
Right.
Yeah, it should be now.
Oh, okay.
It was added at a later point.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Because I didn't download the packet until after you told me today, and I don't have them.
I sent it to Serla this morning.
The ordinance.
She said she
Oh, okay. Her. Yeah, I somehow missed that sentence.
So
I saw the resolution.
Okay.
Next, we have Resolution 2015-28. Let's just go ahead and read the whole thing. It's short, and it actually was revised. We have a different copy on the table than what was in the packet, so let's read it.
Yeah, this is a resolution authorizing the village manager to enter into a lease with Stony Creek Garden Center for village-owned property located at 4550 U.S. 68 North. Whereas the Village of Yellow Springs owns the property at 4550 U.S. 68 North, and whereas Steve and Karen Reed have held the lease since January 15, 2015, and have made significant improvements to the property, and whereas the village manager has negotiated a lease agreement with Steve and Karen Reed of Stony Creek Garden Center, which identifies all terms and conditions contained therein, now therefore the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that. Section 1, the village manager is hereby authorized and directed to enact the attached lease agreement with Steve and Karen Reed of Stony Creek Garden Center, which includes a 2-year term with a rental price of $500 per month. Section 2, the lease shall become effective upon signing and shall remain in effect through December 31st, 2017. Section 3, this resolution shall become effective immediately upon its adoption.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty, I will let you.
As council knows, there was a change of ownership from Yellow Springs Botanicals to Stony Creek Garden Center late in 2014. To that end, we signed a new lease with Stony Creek Garden Center in January of this year. Recently, Karen, Jason Hamby, and myself visited Stony Creek to see how things were progressing, and they've done quite a bit of improving the property. They've got a lot more stock out there, and they did request in writing shortly after that meeting that we consider renewing their lease and potentially extending it so that they could plan their stock purchases for a couple of years. To that end, I recommend to council that we sign a new two-year lease with Stony Creek.
Any comments or questions from council? They have great stuff out there, so if anybody needs, is still doing planting in their gardens.
And they're supposed to get their bicolored mums in this Thursday.
And they do have a lot of natives and a lot of.
So we know.
And they're doing more trees, so it really, they really are working hard to make, you know, to have things that villagers are interested in. Take a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Next is Resolution 2015-29. Just do title only on that one.
All right. This is authorizing cooperative agreement for installation of the bottleneck elimination project between the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and the Ohio Water Development Authority.
Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, Patty, this is yours also.
Again, as council knows, we recently signed the contract with GM Pipeline. It was an alternate bid when we did the loop completion bid, which saves us a substantial amount of money. So we did sign the contract with them to complete the bottleneck elimination project, which is along Xenia Avenue from Cahoe to Herman. At that time, council also agreed that it would be in our best interest in financing this project to secure a loan from the Ohio Water Development Authority, and this resolution gives me the authority to apply for that loan.
Okay. Any questions or comments from council? Citizens? The one thing, or this has nothing to do with the legislation, but just as far as notification project schedule, do we have a...
Johnny's trying to get a firm date from them. They are supposed to start mid to late September and complete by the first of the year, except for the restoration, of course, which will be done in the spring.
And what's involved with the restoration? Will that be sidewalks also?
It will be sidewalks as well as in the areas where necessary seeding the grass. We're trying to dig up as little as possible to get this new line in.
Great. And this is very important to improve the fire flow
right in
the south end of town. It's been necessary for a long time, so we're very happy to be moving forward on that. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. And finally, Resolution 2015-30. Let's read it in full.
All right, this is approving a contract from Melissa Van Zandt for the position of Assistant Village Manager. Whereas the village desires to employ an assistant village manager, and whereas pursuant to Article 4, Section 31 of the Yellow Springs Charter, the village manager appoints subordinate officers and employees of the village, and whereas after a comprehensive series of interviews, the village manager recommends the appointment of Melissa Van Zandt to the position of assistant village manager, and whereas council concurs with the village manager's recommendation that the position of assistant village manager be offered to Melissa Van Zandt, now therefore the council of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio hereby resolves that. Section 1, council hereby approves the terms of the employment agreement or one in substantially similar form attached to this resolution as Exhibit A to be entered into between the village and Melissa Van Zandt. Section 2, the village manager is hereby authorized and directed to execute the employment agreement or one in substantially similar form with Melissa Van Zandt on behalf of the village.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. This is, it's always nice when we're able to, move someone up from within that's been with, Melissa's been with the village for about 2 years now. So the precipitating event to this of John leaving is unfortunate, but it It's great that we had a candidate already with the village, with the credentials and the ability to be able to step into the role. So very happy that Melissa agreed.
And maybe Patty could just talk a little bit about Melissa's credentials, because people may not know all of her background.
Well, Melissa comes to us initially from Wright State University, where she worked in the finance department. I'm not entirely sure where you were before that, but she does not only have a bachelor's degree, but also a master's degree in public administration, just like I do. She is an incredibly dedicated employee and, quite frankly, works circles around everybody, including myself. And so I'm very happy, you know, I'm sad to be losing John, but I'm very happy that Melissa did come to me and express her interest in this and then did follow through and apply so that she could be part of the interview process.
Council, any other comments? Citizens' comments?
I guess I would like to. What additional duties will
Well,
be doing, and how are you going to be able to each
other? We've already discussed some of the duties she'll be taking over. She's going to be taking over some of the committees and commissions, the attending those. Specifically, she'll be working with the what will become Arts and Culture Commission, because Melissa is an artist. I'm not. So that's a pretty good fit, and she will also be working with CAP as far as, you know, working towards getting the fiber network up. She's also going to be overseeing the Safe Routes to School project because Melissa's never done a construction project, and as construction projects go, that one is small and contained and fairly simple, so it's a good way for her to get her feet wet and work with ODOT as another agency. And then we'll be easing her into some of the duties, helping me oversee the planning and zoning a little bit and learning about that. And eventually, we'll just move her a little bit further along.
Great. And I think it's important to note that as the finance director, she really has her hands in every department
she
of
does.
The village also. So she knows all of the supervisors. She knows all of the staff. So she really, next to the village manager already, she probably does have the most knowledge of the rest of the village and the operations.
And Patty, should we talk a little bit about what Denise is going to be doing that'll kind of help balance that?
Yeah, Denise Swinger will be moving into the planning and zoning officer and economic development liaison position, which means that she will be establishing office hours for planning and zoning permits and to answer those types of questions. She'll be attending the BZA and planning commission meetings, and she will be working with Karen on the economic development end of things to keep that moving along.
Can you talk a little bit about any budgetary implications to this change?
This actually saves us money because between the salary that we'll be paying Denise to work the 30 hours a week for the other position and the increase that Melissa got, we're saving about $12,000 a year plus what we pay in John's benefits. Melissa has a better handle on the figures for benefits than I do, but it's about $12,000 plus the benefits that we're actually saving over the course of the year.
And what's the official start date for both of them? Is it the same date for both?
Denise will be coming up to work with John, I believe, Wednesday of this week.
Monday of next week.
And then Melissa is going to be sworn in at our next meeting on the 7th of September?
8th.
I can't get that right to save my
life. That's right.
So she'll be sworn in at that meeting, and that will be the day she officially assumes her duties.
Great.
Because John will be with us through the 4th.
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you. Excellent. Any other comments or questions?
That's
comments
great.
Or questions from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Now is the time in the agenda where we hear from citizens about issues that are not already on the agenda, new issues to be brought before council, or concerns. We ask that you come to the podium, speak into the microphone, give your name, and we allow 3 minutes. I saw you first. Can we do a handheld? Or are you gonna?
Yeah,
are you okay?
Judy's coming.
All right.
My name is Athena Fannin. And where's the timer so I can make sure I stay within?
I'm getting you.
Oh, no rush.
20 seconds.
Okay. I had originally planned to come to this meeting to share with council a stress-producing, intimidating experience that occurred in March as a result of Officer Naomi Penrod's poor decision-making in regards to myself and my children while under a criminal protection order and pending witness testimony. I felt it was important, as you make your personnel decisions going forward, that you have all critical information. However, an event on Friday, August 14th, 2015, has prompted me to delay that communication and instead come here tonight to make a request regarding my family's safety. On August 14th, I was traveling on the road and I noticed a car behind me but didn't think much of it until the car got very close, so close that I could not read the license plate. The car stayed behind me that close despite the ability to pass, and because of its aggressive nature, I took extra care checking out what was going on. It persisted in riding so close to my bumper that it made me nervous because it was so close I couldn't see the license plate even at highway speeds. Eventually, that car went around me in a manner that I would interpret as a little aggressively and sped away. The car matched 7 of 7 publicly available identifiers, including color, make, type, heavy window tint, tinted license plate cover, and a 7th I won't identify for Ms. Penrod's privacy. The car was identified with 100% certainty to be Ms. Penrod's personal vehicle. Not only did Ms. Penrod's car violate multiple traffic laws, including failure to signal, following too close, and after darting around excessive speed, but the tint on the license plate made it difficult to get a plate number. Since January, I've seen a car matching 4 of 7 identifiers driving by my home, on the road going my direction, and matching my turns, and at places I'm likely to be. However, I couldn't be positive about identifying the car as Ms. Penrod's or a coincidence. After Friday, it is clear that the car positively identified as belonging to Ms. Penrod's car at that event is one that I have seen before where it should not have been. In the previous incidents, I could neither see the driver for identification nor get a good visual of the license plate. In Friday's event, I could not identify the driver, though I tried due to heavy tint. Ms. Penrod has demonstrated that she will rely on benefit of the doubt while crossing lines. I believe without definitive proof, my concerns will not be taken seriously. Even if I could get a picture of her plate, I will never be able to prove that it is Ms. Penrod driving as long as she has such dark window tint. It is also protective of Ms. Penrod to be able to document that she is not driving during a concerning incident. I am here today to ask you, please, the council, Chief Hale, and village manager to enforce the tint laws for Ms. Penrod. It is hard for me to believe that her windows, windshields are 70%, 50% translucent, and that she qualifies for an exemption on her personal vehicle. Please require her to correct the tint on her vehicle's license plate cover and her windows and windshield, and at minimum issue her citations and other consequences in keeping with state law until she does. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Athena.
And I apologize because this is just responding.
Anyone else? Any other citizen comments?
Well, just a minute.
Oh.
I would like to ask the chief, I would like to ask you, have you talked to the chief about this?
I had to think long and hard about whether I had the trust, and it is my intention to talk to the chief, but I wanted to make sure that I got it into public record at this point. I will be communicating with the chief and Ms. Bates.
Good. Thank you. Thanks, Marianne. Other comments or other citizen concerns? Paul?
Paul Abendroth, I sent into the packet a picture of the stormwater crossing Rice Road. Several times a year, thousands of gallons of water cross Rice Road into my front yard. Much of it goes down my driveway, eroding it. I have been in communication with the village for years about that situation, and it's not improving. The recommendation that I was given was to sue my neighbors for the increase in the water. I might as well sue the Peabody Coal Company for global warming causing the increase in water. I would like a qualified civil engineer to assess the situation and create a correction for that situation. It is not what I expect of the village to do. Most villages, most communities, collect stormwater, take it to the nearest corner, and then on to a tributary somewhere. This water runs across neighbors' yards, across my yard, across my other neighbor's yard, under the road, and in several places. I don't find that satisfactory. So if you would please solve that problem for me. I have another stormwater problem, which I will address after that is done. Which brings me to policy. Obviously, my idea of what the village should do in the terms of stormwater differ from staff. And I ask council to be very clear in your own minds and in the documentation, the role of the village in maintaining stormwater. A new development, a contractor puts in water pipes and streets and gutters and whatever, and then the village maintains it. Stormwater, the only thing I see the village doing is requiring any contractor that comes for a variation, to show on paper that they will not make matters worse. And that's all I see in the village documentation about the role of the village in stormwater. I believe it should be the village's role, just like sewer, water, electricity, streets. So please look at your policy on sewer water and make it clear what you feel the role should be. Thank you.
Thanks, Paul.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay. We'll come back.
Perhaps the village solicitor could, or somebody could help us. Maybe, actually, it could be the assistant VM or Denise could help us look into policies on stormwater.
It's becoming an issue all over the country. What communities are starting to do is to set up a stormwater utility where residents pay a fee, a utility fee that would be on their utility bills, so, or added on to their assessed to their property. So it is, if it's something that the village is going to tackle, I think we're going to have to, you know, it's probably going to require some funding from citizens.
So I'm gathering from what you're saying, Karen, and just experiencing on my property, that at present, our infrastructure doesn't have the capacity in some places to deal with this situation. And given the climate change,
right,
this is going to keep happening more.
It either doesn't have the capacity or it doesn't have the infrastructure to begin with. I mean, there are multiple places in the village that just don't have stormwater drainage. Yeah, they are being required in new developments. Stormwater is being required to be properly, you know, moved away. But in a lot of the older sections of the village, I literally at least once a week, Jason and or I get a phone call or go to a meeting with someone who's having a stormwater issue. We did just today had a meeting with someone about a stormwater issue. And what we're trying to do is complete projects as they come up that affect multiple properties, because that's the easiest way to take care of larger problems. The stormwater drainage that was improved on Davis Street last winter is one example, because there were multiple properties involved in that, and there'll be another project coming up on Davis. Today we talked to some folks on at Dayton and Walnut about the stormwater that's coming over from Winter Street in the area over there, and how it's just all shunting because of the topography. It's shunting down. And we're working to look behind the businesses over here on Dayton Street in the 100 block or 200 block to try to figure out how to dispose of that end of it. And then we'll work in between that on projects. So we are trying to look at projects that affect multiple property owners that could solve a lot of more problems at one time. But it's going to take a long time to get it done.
And a lot of money. Additional expense.
Right.
I have a feeling that probably makes the sidewalk discussion look small.
Minuscule. Yeah, because you're not doing something that's on the surface. You're digging up infrastructure, and you're hitting bedrock in a lot of places.
Millions of dollars.
Yes. And a lot of it has to be engineered. I mean, we're doing, Jason's crew is doing projects that are simple and straightforward, that are helping to improve the drainage in a lot of places. But in some of them, they have to be engineered. And if it gets really, really complicated, we'll have to have a contractor do it. So, I mean, that just ups the ante right there even more.
And just to be clear, not that I want to shove off responsibility, but this is years. This is 100 years or more in the making. Mm-hmm. This isn't anything that has happened recently. And actually, as Patty said, all development probably in the last 15 to 20 years has been required to provide stormwater management.
Right.
And so the problem is not continuing.
Right.
So it's...
And this was literally one of the first problems I became aware of when I was hired, because the evening that I got up here early for my two-day interview process was the night of the 100-year storm or the 500-year storm or whatever the heck it was. And I went out for a walk, and I was walking down Limestone Street on the sidewalk, or not Limestone, Xenia Avenue on the sidewalk in 2 inches of water. Mm-hmm. Right. So it's everywhere.
Right.
And yeah, but we're working at it. It's gonna take a very long time and a lot of money.
And I am glad to hear, and it sounds like Paul's not satisfied, but I am glad to hear that staff is working on these issues, and Paul came to my office today and we talked about it, and I did ask Patty to respond and for staff to do, when they're doing projects, to make sure that what we're doing isn't contributing
right.
More to the problem with street work and other work.
Right, and one thing that I think a lot of people aren't aware of, I mean, it doesn't take much to make your neighbor's stormwater problem worse. It can be as simple as you diverting a couple of downspouts in a way that they don't affect your property as much, but they could affect somebody else. I mean, it could be as simple as you changing your landscape. So please, when you're doing things like that, be cognizant of where you're putting the water, because it's probably going to go onto somebody else's property.
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Can you come up, please, so we can hear you?
It's our standard practice. It's kind of a pain, and I know it kind of makes you self-conscious, so I'm sorry. But we're on television, and it's helpful for the people at home to be able to have you speak into a microphone and be able to see you.
Good evening. I'm Alice Earl Jenkins, and I've been a resident of Yellow Springs since 1985. The question I want to ask is, are there federal and state government funds that could be available for that kind of structural work for the water?
Yes, ma'am. The largest funder for that type of thing is the Ohio Public Works Commission.
Okay.
And it's bond money, and it was just actually renewed last year, so we're good for another 10 years. The problem with that is that, number one, each county is allocated a certain amount of money, or each district is allocated a certain amount of money based on population. Mm-hmm. And Greene County is part of District 11, and you can only apply for one project a year. We applied this year to have part of the water plant funded next year. Next year, conceivably, we could apply for a grant to do a full street reconstruction, which would include stormwater, or to just do a stormwater project. But you're limited to applying for one project a year.
Okay. Well, I hope that that the council will consider Omar Circle for the street stormwater, because the infrastructure for that was done back in 1950s, and the community was smaller, but now it collects in the west cul-de-sacs of Omar Circle. So I would like to see that included in the project for the third year.
Mm-hmm.
I think it came to three to four years. Third year.
Yeah, I think what we're eventually going to have to do is Jason and I are going to have to sit down and just prioritize that entire list of projects for stormwater and try to just start knocking them out, you know, one at a time. But I've written that down so that we don't forget you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jenkins. What about Clean Ohio money?
Clean Ohio doesn't normally handle just stormwater. Okay. It has to be a brownfield or something like that, riparian corridor.
Last call for citizens' concerns, additional? Okay, we'll move on to special reports. This is a discussion of approaches to economic sustainability that is being led by Assistant Village Manager John Young.
So you all have a copy of the four-page kind of overview of some ideas and strategies that I come up with to just reflection on my 7.5 months here in the village and ideas on how to move forward with economic development after I'm gone. Just a bit of a background on this. I've village planning office has a compendium of plans and surveys regarding economic development spanning the last 15 years, whether it be Sustainable Yellow Springs, the Miami Township and Yellow Springs Visioning Plan, the Business Retention Survey, or even the Comprehensive Plan. This is a topic that has been under discussion for quite some time, and rightfully so, as the nature of the economy in the village has changed since the year 2000, with some very important employers closing or leaving the village. The closing of the college in 2008 was also accelerated fears of decline. However, the college and the university, since splitting, have been able to rebound, and there are new businesses such as EnviroFlight and the brewery that have opened up as well. So the village is continuing to position itself organically in a 21st century economy, focusing around innovation, entrepreneurship, and developing businesses that fit within the brand identity of the village, which are all very good things. However, there are a lot of large parcel properties in the village that could be developed to really take the village to the next level economically. Some of those parcels are pretty identifiable, whether they're owned by the village or not. So, for example, the CBE property or the Glass Farm, those are properties that are very large that need some direction from either the village or entities that own those properties. There are properties that are not owned by the village that the village can still act as an intermediary to work with property owners to help bring some level of economic vitality to those properties. So some of the things that I kind of look at when I approach economic development, I looked at a couple of things and as an outline here, and these are just an expansion on some of the things that I talked about with the Chamber of Commerce a couple of months ago. My approach to the economic development in the village would be a couple of prongs. One would be to create a regulatory environment that that enables development that the village wants.
John,
and that, excuse me,
can I
yes.
ask you, would you elaborate on that? What kind of regulations or what kind of regulatory environment are you talking about?
I was getting to that.
Okay.
Regulations for the development type of village wants, but also balances the needs of developers. So what I'm talking about with what the village would want, we have the comprehensive plan. We have the Miami Township and Yellow Springs vision document, which does a very good job of fleshing out what the public and what the discourse was back when that was developed. I think you have to look at what is the right type of growth for a place like Yellow Springs. Obviously, something like sprawl would not work here, and I never would recommend sprawl to anybody. That is not the way to grow for a place that is as unique and as diverse in characteristics as the village. So what is the type of growth? it would be the type of growth that would be in the character of the village, that would enhance the organic diversity and the ambience of the village, that is smart in the sense that it is sustainable, that it is eco-friendly, that is equitable, and that is oriented more towards the pedestrian than it is to the automobile. Does that answer your question at all?
No. I mean, I guess I'll ask it another way. Are there regulations that we currently have that you think we should change, or are there regulations that we don't have that you think we should put in place? I guess okay. I'm wanting more specific.
Yes.
That was pretty specific, but I think she wants an expansion.
I'm getting there. You guys are making my last meeting very tough. Not really. One of the things that I worked on while I was in Bellevue was a form-based code. And the form-based code for Bellevue was a community-led process that involved a process that is very similar to how the Antioch Eco Village was developed. Mm-hmm. We brought in planning consultants. We did a five-day charrette. We had stakeholders, property owners from over half the city come. To over 200 people showed up. And we did it on with a quarter of the staff that the Antioch Eco Village had. We developed a regulatory framework that identified the type of development that the village wanted and the different levels, it's not the village, the city wanted, and different levels of urbanity that they desired. And we measured those zones. We created new zones based on what is called a transect, which is based on a natural order of things. So the natural transect is from the river, the pond, to the mountain, in each different type of environment. So there's a aquatic environment, a desert environment, a wetlands, or a prairie environment, and the forest, and then the mountain environment. So that's a natural transect. And what the urban transect is something that moves from open conservation space to a downtown. We based our different levels of these different zones on our own city. I actually went out and measured neighborhoods for net density, for lot width, for the types of buildings that were there, and we based our code on what Bellevue was. And I think that there's a tremendous opportunity to develop a zoning code here that is based on the village, what the village is, and what the village wants. And it's a by right development code that is a lot easier for an average person to understand, for all of us up here to understand, and for potential developers to understand.
Yeah, but we just spent a lot of money redoing zoning code.
Yeah, I mean, that's not going to happen. So let's talk about something that's reasonable.
Well, she asked the question.
Well, yeah.
So.
I mean,
he has three suggestions in the document. Well, not
but I mean, I guess the reason why I'm bringing this up is because there are some limits to what the village government can do. I mean, and it seems like one of the things we can do is what you're saying is create an environment to attract what we want.
Yeah. So
that is the biggest thing we can do, I guess, is create an environment to attract what we want.
And in light of the revision of the zoning code, there are still opportunities within the current zoning framework to make it easier for developers and to also ensure that the community gets what it wants. Right. So we can operate within the framework of the zoning code.
Right. I mean, he says the simplified zoning code process is just simply allowing upper-level apartments by right downtown, reorganize sections such as assigning section to be more readable and clear, clarify regulatory inconsistencies regarding driveways, patios, and chickens.
and to be clear, we intentionally, I think when we went zoning code process, we thought we were going to do a form-based code. And through working, through the TRC working, and through working with our consultant, it was decided that a form-based code did not work for Yellow Springs because it was too prescriptive. And we had too much variability already in our fabric to introduce something that would put the kind of strict requirements on zoning that form-based code does. So it was we didn't ignore it. We didn't It didn't go over our head. We weren't, it just, it was discussed and it was dismissed as not appropriate for Yellow Springs. And what we tried to do was come up with a hybrid code. I'm not, you know, I'm not saying that, I know that there are issues with our code, but the intent of our code was to do much of what you're talking about. And if it doesn't, we've got to fix it. We've got to fix what doesn't do that.
Right. And I think that John's been working on that and has a quite a list going, if I'm not mistaken.
And I apologize. I realize that I didn't read the last two pages of your document for some reason. So I didn't see some of the suggestions. Sorry.
Okay. Well,
but I guess I will say, John, to Marianne's point, if there are some other things, and we don't have to talk about them all tonight, that are de-incentivizing, you know, development and people coming in that you've noticed, please leave that, you know, with Patty.
Yeah, definitely.
Can I tell you what's de-incentivizing development is that there is no place for them to move into. I will tell you that that is probably one of the biggest limitations we have right now, is a lack of available space for what businesses are looking for. And people are interested. In the last 3 weeks, I have made contact with two food production companies, an electronics company, and a finance company, and things are moving forward with two of those companies. And so, you know, when we find the right kind of prospects and the right kind of, and both of those people want to be in Yellow Springs. They actually want to live in Yellow Springs. They like the values, the business values, and the philosophical values of Yellow Springs. And that's why they want to be here. I think that that's really our niche. Our niche is about, and you know, I know that this was a lot of the discussion around the CBE, and you know, we can't just build it and they will come. And I really am starting to agree with that. Even though I said we need space, we need to figure out how to get those things to happen, how to encourage and reach out to people that are going to be philosophically aligned with some of the opportunities here in Yellow Springs. I mean, we've got a food sector. We've got a food sector without question.
Yeah, I think we have to be creative. I agree.
Yeah.
Okay. So another thing I was talking about in this ethos is also something along the lines of developing a catalytic approach to development. This is definitely a strategy that would encourage the type of economic development that would also create returns and dividends as far as ancillary development. For example, a lot of the basic theory under economic base modeling is that there are basic jobs and non-basic jobs. Basic jobs are types of jobs that are basically the manufacturing or the educational jobs that bring ancillary service jobs with them. There's always like a, depending on where that rating is, there's a multiplier as to how many service jobs that come with a more basic job. So developing the type of catalytic development that brings in the type of businesses that would create residual job growth as well as something that is something that could be encouraged, and then that in turn would help develop more properties and bring them out of bring them back into usage and also some new things in different areas. So that is basically the gist of it. The village has limited resources, so it needs to be careful in determining what projects and efforts contribute to its vision for a prosperous village. I've listed five initiatives that I think would be beneficial in pursuing for economic growth. The first one is to strengthen downtown Yellow Springs. And some of these things the village is already working on, such as the streetscape, which is slated to be completed next year. This helps bring a stability and a common identity to the business district, which will help with the overall appearance. The second point is something I've been working with Karen on in the chamber, and that's developing wayfinding signage to help direct visitors to the different areas of downtown Yellow Springs, especially the Dayton Street area. these types of signs should be non-intrusive but still identifiable, so they shouldn't be in your way, but they should be somehow, there should be somewhere where you can see them. And we've been working on some different designs, so hopefully that will move forward after I leave. The other thing is that increasing the public art possibilities. The village already does a really good job with murals and artist benches and trash cans. There are other opportunities to paint the street or crosswalks or other public places, to look into doing some interactive murals. And the picture I have in the report is actually a really cool mural from Georgetown in Malaysia, where it's a mural of kids playing basketball, but the hoop and the basket are real. There's another couple of murals, one with the kids riding bicycles and the bicycle is real, or swinging on swings and the swing is real. And this is something that just really has allowed, people are interacting with the art, and it's really kind of generated this vibrancy, which is really, really cool to see, and I've quite honestly haven't seen anywhere else. You don't have to get Banksy to come and do murals, but I think there's a lot of talent here in the village that can do something, some pretty awesome stuff. So capitalizing on that. The next is to implement the downtown Wi-Fi project, which we had been working on with the community access panel. This will improve outside vendor access for street fair and other temporary or mobile food vending places that are located, let's say, at BP or elsewhere. It also encourages people to stay downtown longer so they can bring their laptops or other electronic devices and actually connect to the Wi-Fi and hang out outside and order a coffee and stay a little bit longer. So that would help a little bit in getting more people downtown. And then also just develop a facade improvement grant to refresh the look of some downtown storefronts. And this can be also be used to improve some of the facades of downtown buildings that maybe are seeing some neglect. Maybe their gutters are somewhat in disrepair, or they've brought a broken window. It could help with that as well. The second prong is to remove barriers to development and redevelopment. One is that the first point is to identify state, federal, and other grants and financing programs. This is something to really just kind of know what's out there. You have to use, there are different tools for different types of projects to get certain development deals done. The big one that comes up in every community is TIF financing, but you know, the one thing with TIF is that you are foregoing a certain amount of a taxable income over a certain time, and also does affect school districts. So knowing that it's out there, knowing how it works, and seeing if you can use it, if it's beneficial, I think is a good idea. Knowing what the other options are good as well. The second thing is a little more doable in-house, and that's creating a portfolio of high-value properties that are available, whether it be CV or the Glass Farm or the Renee site, whether it's owned by a village or not. Knowing that it's out there, knowing what the zoning is, knowing how big it is, knowing what utility access it has, and also what deed restrictions and covenants it has, is something that would really help if somebody is interested in locating in the village, to identify what the proper site is for them. So I have a listing here of a couple of the sites that are pretty, that would be catalytic, the CBE, the Glass Farm, Bernays site, former Wright State site on Xenia, and the Antioch Eco Village.
The Dayton Street parking lot needs to be
and the Dayton Street parking lot, yes. Yes. That's huge. You expand, find creative ways to expand retail opportunities. For the size of population that the village attracts, it is considered under-retailed to the population that serves, and that includes residents and visitors. However, the village downtown does have everything that you would ever want to have for a community, a grocery store, a hardware store, a drugstore, all the essential services, a laundromat. Those are absolutely great things to have and essential, and it's amazing that you guys have them. There are places all over the country that don't have grocery stores. Anyway, downtown storefront activity should focus on retail. There should be an effort underway to try to remove non-pedestrian foot traffic uses such as offices and residences from the lower floors to the upper floors if they're there. This would help create more foot traffic and enhance the vibrancy of people moving along the business district and enhance the flow of pedestrian traffic. And then also increase pedestrian and bicycle access to the southern business district. That would be by renovating or figuring out a way to put in a better bicycle access to the south business district, and also to fix the sidewalk down there. And one thing I didn't put in here actually would be to expand bicycle parking in downtown. There's, for the amount of bicyclists that actually come to the village, there's actually not a lot of bicycle parking. And I just kind of go off on a brief tangent. There had been some discussion about creating a place or a temporary or a town square downtown that would be that would serve as maybe a place for bicycle parking, maybe for food trucks, outdoor dining areas, stuff like that. That would be maybe on a in an area downtown, maybe Short Street or Corey or somewhere in downtown that would could function as a community gathering space. That'd be outdoors. Next bullet point is expand housing opportunities. Currently, there is a lot of demand for housing, but there's a low supply for housing, which has created an artificial price bubble of sorts. This inflated price is basically to the point where it has made it a little bit harder for lower income demographics to move into the village. This is something that I'm sure you all are aware of. The McKee Group has the cost of living studies. There are really only a couple of ways to get out of this kind of conundrum. One is a market-based approach, which would be to build more housing. The other one would be to mandate low-income housing through some regulatory tactics, whether it be through helping with low-income housing tax credit program projects, or to develop a zoning instrument that would mandate low-income housing and new developments. Those are some options that would encourage the development of lower income housing in the future. And then finally, simplifying the zoning code, allowing upper level apartments as a permitted use in downtown instead of having to take them before the Planning Commission. This is something that the upper level units in a lot of apartments would have to get a certificate of occupancy from the building department. So the usage of them as residential actually is more of a building regulatory standpoint than it would be a zoning standpoint. I think the biggest concern would be to limit residential on the bottom floors of retail buildings instead. So you would want to have, like I said, residential on top or offices. Organizing the section, the signage section, which I'm actually working on right now, there's a lot of things in the zoning code that are stated the signage code, for example, I would say it's a lot of regulations are stated over and over again for different zones. Mm-hmm. And reformulating that to say, here's what the signs are and here's what types of signs are allowed in which zone would actually reduce that section by about 3 or 4 pages.
Because it's a wall mm-hmm. of text that I found impenetrable. Yeah.
There are a lot of other things that need to be put in here. It's the regulation on setbacks for driveways are unclear. We used to have a permission for chickens, and we don't anymore. We don't have any regulations for swimming pools. Stuff like that.
Can I go back?
It's missing.
Yeah. Can I go back to the upper level apartments?
Sure.
What role does the Greene County Building Department play in that? Because I know I was mm-hmm. involved in going to a hearing where they were not going to allow an upper level apartment because of fire safety.
So if you have an upper level apartment right now, you're typically grandfathered in. Ohio regulates under the International Building Code for commercial structures, and typically I think with second floors you're okay, but when you get to the third floor you need to have a second means of egress. So a lot of places in historic downtowns have fire escapes which are still grandfathered and can be utilized. However, you can't build any new fire escapes, and really fire code and building code is moving away from fire escapes. So if you're going to do a rehab, you have to have install a secondary staircase interior. So that, I think, is the big challenge
so
with
one in the front, one in the back.
And some I don't remember offhand, but there are some instances where the code would kick in for renovations for second-level apartments. So in that instance, though, by requiring someone to go to the Planning Commission, you're just adding another regulatory hurdle for them to go through when they already have to deal with the building code and the fire code.
Right.
So just getting them to the CO, I think, is going to be the challenge.
Yeah, well, it'll be great for you to just leave behind all of your suggestions for the zoning code and make sure that they make it, so we can make sure they make it through the Planning Commission.
And another thing is, like, I am available by phone.
Yeah.
As well, in the future.
Yes, we made that clear.
Okay. You can always contact me. So clarifying regulatory inconsistencies as well. There are sections in the Code of Ordinances regarding noise and industrial districts that should actually be in the zoning code. So there are other parts that actually need to just move to the zoning code to be more coherent. Mm-hmm. The subdivision regulations need to be revised significantly. We don't have any standards in our code for sidewalk or driveway construction. So it just says refer to village engineering standards, which I have never seen. Okay. We don't have them.
Right.
So getting those things established, being clear on that, that way next planning and zoning person can say, this is what the regulation is, instead of saying, I'm not sure, we don't have anything. So we're getting that up there is pretty important. And that alone helps make things easier. So getting back to the third prong, which is a creation of a job creation, a tax incentive. This would be an incentive that would incentivize the creation expansion of existing businesses and also a tool to lure new businesses to the village. There are no bullet points under this because it's intentionally fluid. Typically, in my experience, there's always kind of a general plan for approaching a job creation tax incentive. However, a lot of times each tax incentive is tailored towards the type of business that is being discussed with. So if you're luring somebody in, it might be a different type of plan than maybe retaining a business or encouraging a business to grow. The next prong is a developer relationship with existing businesses, and that would be coordinating with the chamber and on business outreach and making sure that that economic development person is meeting with some of the big top employers in the village and just kind of touching base with them to find out how they're doing. Also to create a new business packet that would outline village requirements and incentives and be basically like a welcome package. For a lot of businesses that come to the village, typically the chamber seems to be their first point of contact for the most part. I mean, not everyone's required to go there, but most people do. So that would be kind of a good way to get out there and get some of our policies out there and be more proactive in saying this is how things are, instead of having to develop a negative interaction with a business because they're violating the signed ordinance by not having a permit for a sign or some other thing. So the final thing here is really looking at the revolving loan program. Which has been around for quite some time. The last records that we actually have from the revolving loan fund was from 2012, 2013. I think the last time anyone actually got a loan from it was like 2010, mm-hmm. 2011. There is approximately 38 grand, I think, in the loan fund as of the last report. The loan fund was developed as a CDBG grant, from my understanding, that would the interest and the payment repayments from that would then be used to finance more loans in the future. However, prior economic development coordinators looked into whether or not we still need to follow the CDBG guidelines, and it's pretty there's really no documentation anymore about whether or not funds are connected to CDBG and have to be utilized under that grant program. It's a pretty old grant program. That's an opportunity. This gives us an opportunity to possibly reposition this revolving loan in a way that would be another economic development tool for bringing in catalytic development. Some of the things that were identified from the prior loan program is that the application requirements are too stringent. I did go through those requirements from the folder in the village manager's office. There are a lot of things that that are being asked for in that program that I don't think they exist anymore. Some like the providing proof of meeting certain requirements that may have been updated by HUD or by other federal agencies. So we would have to find out what the new forms that they're asking for, or look at different requirements altogether. I think there was no clarity on how the funds could be spent from the CDBG perspective, and then also all the funding was, all the loans were approved by Village Council, so tied a political process to the approval process. So we kind of, Sarah Wildman and I kind of knocked heads on this, so so some of this is kind of what I came out of from talking with her, and we think that, I think that repositioning the fund to be a catalytic development fund used on transformative projects would be a good idea, would really kind of focus the fund on being a fund that would be, a loan that would be for creating more long-term growth. It could be a main, it's, the tool is, intent is a gap financing tool, but right now it serves as, you need to show proof that you were denied a loan.
Yeah.
Which I think sets up a situation where you might have more bad creditors. I mean, as a, if a, I think we have situations where I've worked in over the Rhine, where people have gotten loans, but they still have that extra $10,000 they need to make the project work. And I think utilizing it more in that perspective, where we've got the we've got financing from a bank, but we don't have enough financing to actually make the project work or make the business work. That's where this can come in as being a gap financing tool. And I actually kind of have some experience in working on that. The other thing is that it could also entertain additional components to the revolving loan fund. It doesn't have to be just for gap financing. It could also be used for maybe as part of the facade improvement program or any other initiative that would require an incentive in the village. So maybe we do facade improvement, maybe do sustainable development as it uses an incentive for doing green development, getting maybe a project to LEED certification. So another recommendation would be to move the approval process to the Economic Sustainability Committee, reforming that, bringing in experts in economic development that would serve on that committee would help remove politics from the process and make it a more objective review. I think there would be probably a component where you could appeal a decision from the Economic Sustainable Committee to Village Council. And then village staff would make recommendations on the application to the board on that in those cases. So there would be a clear recommendation from staff whether something would be approved or should be approved or denied. There would be clear findings of fact, because when you're working with loaning out money, you want to make sure that the person that you're loaning money to is going to pay you back, but also they're going to do what they say they're going to do. Mm-hmm. So having some more strict regulations or strict controls on that would help ensure that the village is funding successful projects and not losing out on money and having to collect it through a collections or a litigation process. I put in collateral or stronger repercussions for non-payments. The point is basically to find a mechanism to ensure that the loans that are given out are repaid. Mm-hmm. Or if they're not, if conditions aren't met, there's some level of clawback mm-hmm. in those agreements. And then the applicant should provide a business plan as part of an application. It's something I didn't really see in the actual loan program right now, mm-hmm. but a lot of Main Street programs, a lot of business district programs require the presentation of a business plan.
Right.
And it's not criticizing whether or not the business is good or bad. It's that if the business, small business owner is disciplined enough to actually sit down, come up with a plan, identify where they want to be in 6 months, where they're going to get their funding from, and have all that stuff clearly laid out, mm-hmm. that as a mental exercise in and of itself helps with applications, helps identify business, helps prepare small business owners for actually enduring rough times when unexpected things come up. So knowing how, looking at that and knowing how to tackle some of that stuff in the future, I think is very, very important, and I think would strengthen applications to the loan program. So my final words are, there's a lot of ideas, a lot of suggestions, a lot of strategies I put into this. There's suggestions. I'm not going to be able to work on this after I leave. I think that the Village is a unique place, and it's a great place, and there's no place like it in the United States, really, or in the world. I mean, there's no comparison to Malaysia, at least. I've been to their villages. Doesn't look like Yellow Springs. The Village has plenty of strengths. Its uniqueness, its character, its history, its vibe, play to those strengths. These are inherent assets to the Village, and they're something that can continue to pay dividends in the long term. And my final word is to continue to innovate, is to continue to explore new ideas, see what other cities, towns, and villages are doing here and around the world, and adapt those innovations to grow the Village in a positive way. You know, a lot of places say, I just want to be like Portland, or I just want to be like Austin, Texas. And if you're always going to try to be like some other place, then you're always going to be number two to those places. It's about taking what you see from those places and using those ideas not as something to copy, but as inspiration for developing your own ideas. And I think the Village has the intellectual capital and the energy and the commitment as a community to get all that stuff done. So do you guys have any questions?
That's great. It's really specific. I really appreciate the detailed information and the details that are not in there that you can hand on to the next people who are going to be doing this.
So, Council, what do we want to do? What is our next step with this topic?
Well, what I would like to do or propose, and this is why I asked Judy to just pull out the from the vision document, the structure for the vision board, and also the page that's still on our website of what the Economic Sustainability Commission looked like. I feel like we've got a lot of ideas. We need to start doing things with those ideas. And so I thought we could discuss, are we going to revive the ESC? Are we going to go with the vision board strategy? I mean, in fact, the way the vision planning went was that the Economic Sustainability Commission would support the vision board so that you would actually have both of these entities.
It's too many.
Right. I mean, but that was the original plan, right?
Yeah, and I think that was, it kind of fell apart because it was just too much to have two boards.
And in fact, when I look at how the ESC was structured, it had many of these representatives. I mean, we had ex officios from the schools and everything. So I would like us to, you know, start soliciting people that are interested and get something going.
As somebody who does this on a daily basis, I think we've got a couple of low-hanging fruit here that I would like to tackle, and that is doing the inventory of properties. I think that can be, I think we could probably hire a real estate company or somebody to do that for us. John said it could, it's something that could potentially be done by staff. I don't think in our current situation it could be. So I would like to ask Patty to maybe look into what that might cost, and also updating the revolving loan
program.
When
you say inventory properties, properties that aren't being utilized?
No, properties
the ones he listed in.
Not just those. Properties that landlords own, properties that can be rented, so that if somebody comes, somebody contacts the Economic Sustainability Coordinator or the planner or me at the chamber, I know I can say all of these properties are available. Something that's searchable on the website, and that'll work with the new website because we can start to link maps and things and have this information all available on our website. Mm-hmm. And then the revolving loan program, getting that rewritten and repurposed, and you know, potentially we could even, you know, I think there is an economic development fund, right, Melissa?
Yeah,
that maybe we could take
$22,000 in it, and it was hard hard to differentiate the path in which, the paths in which the money flowed in. So it's got a total of 122 that sat in there untouched for quite a long time. So it looks like 38 of it was the loan fund, and then the rest of it was probably put in there to support staff.
It
via
was.
Transfers and
right.
things.
It was, and then I think when we hired John, we didn't draw on that to pay his salary, so it's just sitting there.
Mm-hmm.
So it is potentially, we could, if we, it feels to me like it would be a good idea to have the Economic Sustainability
Absolutely.
Board to redo uh-huh. the loan fund and decide what to do with that money, whether to just put it into the loan fund or use part of it for one thing and part of it for something else. That would be my suggestion.
I guess I would ask Patty. I mean, I think because the Economic Sustainability looked at the loan fund, I think that's potentially something that could be written by a professional.
Well,
too.
the thing about it is, I mean, to do just a cursory inventory is a fairly simple thing, but I think what we're talking about here is a lot more detailed. I think that you want to include properties that may be in residential zones but could conceivably be a small office of some type. You know, I think you want to include the big parcels like the CBE or the Vernet site or the Wright State site. So it can't hurt to look into a company and see, and potentially the money that's in that fund could partially go towards paying that consultant
right.
to create that inventory.
I just know that, I mean, what we had with the ESC before, what we need are tools. We you know, I think that there's a lot of wheel spinning going on mm-hmm. because we need the tools to be able to market properties, to be able to market opportunities, and the loan fund, having that in place, and having some parameters around that, I think are, mm-hmm.
Well, so we're running about a half hour behind.
Right, I know.
So I think we should, I don't know, I would say maybe a couple of people put their heads together on this particular issue.
Well,
and
I think I have a suggestion that might work out, because I know this is kind of something that Brian is very interested in helping to maybe take off a little bit. And I think that the money is a big part of it. So perhaps Brian and Melissa could work together.
Well, I would like to be involved in that, too.
And Karen will work together on and get that funding part clearly delineated and
right.
start there.
Okay. That
and
sounds
I'll
good.
Check into some companies to do the inventory.
And okay. do we have consensus that we want to revive the Economic Sustainability Commission?
Yes.
I think we can task certain things, because I would like to then put an ad out and start to, you know, get interest from people on that area.
And then Denise would be working with this.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
Because mm-hmm. I think with some of these things, just
and
like with other commissions, yeah,
Melissa,
I'm sorry.
Probably too.
Right.
No, I'm just saying Melissa could do it.
And, you know, we've got some, you know, defined tasks, and I think commissions have been really good at moving those things forward. So I think that's great. Yeah.
Well, I think you also should get a recommitment from the current members that we have listed here.
Well, we should find out if they were interested in recommitting. Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, because, you know.
Okay, and so then I'll just mention that, you know, the process for commissions, which is now codified, is that we like a resume and a letter of interest sent to our clerk, and then we'll go from there.
So we'll take, we've heard from council, we'll take a couple of minutes to see if there are any comments from citizens before we move on. Okay, thank you. We will move on to old business.
Can we move the work session review? I know a lot of the people here are for policing
sure.
policy. Can we just discuss
yeah, well, the session? So we're going to, do you want to do the policing policy now?
I wonder if Duard is
oh yeah, Duard's
first
here. And
Duard's going to
okay.
take like 5 minutes.
Okay,
five
so then
minutes?
We'll
okay.
go with Duard, then we'll move the police policy discussion next, and then we'll, so, Marianne, are we just going to turn this over to Duard?
We are.
Okay. There you are.
All right. I'd like to thank the Village Council and the Village Manager and Yellow Springs for the opportunity to talk about climate change and climate action in Yellow Springs. I'm not going to go into the content that's in the packet in the quarterly update. From a real high level, both in Yellow Springs and in the world, there's a lot going on from an impact of climate change and from the desire for action, but there's not really a whole lot of action that's taking place either on the global level or on the local level. There's a lot of galvanization that we need to act, is essentially what's happening. The recommendations haven't changed a lot. The main recommendation is that we move forward with formal climate action planning for the village and that the council make a leadership commitment to doing that.
Or do you want to talk a little bit about ICLEI and that might be a
Sure. So in order to move forward with climate action planning, one of the key things is to have the tool sets and the access to the expertise to move forward with that process. Right now, the only organization that's available for that is ICLEI. It really doesn't stand for anything anymore, but they're about sustainable communities. The EPA said for a long time that they're going to have tools available. That just hasn't happened, not surprising. So for us to really move forward with establishing our carbon footprint for the village, and then defining what we want to do about that, and then actually putting a plan together, getting access to the tools that ICLEI has and their expertise is the critical next step.
What's the membership fees for joining ICLEI?
It's an annual $600 fee.
Oh, okay.
So, and we have talked about where would this money come from, and I think we, we talked with Patty about this, and she suggested that the Green Space Fund would be an appropriate fund source for it. And I guess I would just like to tag on to, of course, I mean, the primary concern is the sustainability, at least of human life on Earth. But in terms of the village itself, we've just been talking about how to enhance our economic, how can we attract the kind of businesses that we want. And I think this kind of thing of a village that is going on record of making climate change, a planning for climate change, is one kind of thing, I think, that could be attracting the kind of businesses that we would like to have here. So I can see it as a partially as an economic development strategy.
Well, and we have a problem. We have problems with stormwater that are going to get worse. We've just spent a lot of time talking about it. So hopefully ICLEI can give us some tools to help us figure out our way forward on some of these things. $600 is pretty small for the first year. I don't know if the funding source matters
that
much.
I was going to say, I don't want it to come out of the Green Space
Fund.
I think
council has funds for memberships too.
Right. Well, yeah. I mean, we can find $600.
Yeah, and I don't want it out of the Green
Space
Fund.
Do we need a motion here? Do you want to make a motion?
I do want to ask Stuart a question. Okay. But I mean, when I see that Oberlin spent $25,000, I can't believe that you're going to get, you know, even $10,000 worth of consulting services out of ICLEI. So do you reasonably think that the committee, that the Resilience Network is going to be able to actually write this climate action plan, or do you think we're going to be looking at consulting fees?
So there's always a possibility that could happen, but the tools that are available now were not available when Oberlin went through their process. And speaking with the main person who runs their climate action plan, Doug actually said, if the tools were available then, we could have used the tools and saved the $25,000. He actually said he thinks that we can do it with the resources that we have on the Environmental Commission and the Energy Board and other people in the community to complete the not only the planning process, but then the ongoing monitoring process as well.
And what are you looking at for your time frame?
So one of the key next steps is to establish that formal time frame. There's several steps. The first step is to create that inventory, and there we're looking from anywhere, you know, from 6 to 12 months. 6 would be very aggressive for a very simple plan. 12 months is for a more detailed long plan, but somewhere in that range. overall, realistically, by the time we actually start enacting a plan, 18 months is aggressive, most likely probably 2 years.
Okay, thank you.
Just real quickly, can you mention sort of the, just briefly, the expansiveness of ICLEI? Because I know they have a variety of tools that I think...
Yeah, they have a lot of tools around sustainability, and you mentioned the stormwater issue. They have a lot of tools around planning for and actually creating pathways for resilience. So their scope is a lot broader than just climate change. They realize that the issues are a lot broader. There's issues around inclusion and equity that they get involved in as well. So.
Right. Thanks. Was somebody going to make a motion?
Yes. Okay. I move that we approve the village government joining ICLEI.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you.
Thanks. Was there anything else from you?
Not at this point.
Thank you.
Duard, if you'll get me the membership information, and we'll get it filled out.
Okay. So now we're going to do the policing policy discussion follow-up. I'll turn that over to Brian and Mary Ann.
Okay. Brian and I work both on a vision statement and on next steps. And what we did is we took the things that we heard from the two community forums that we had that HRC hosted last year. I guess they were both last year.
No, there was October and then March of this year.
And then the more recent forum where council itself talked about what we wanted in a police department. And we developed a draft vision statement that is a vision of what we want, what we think that we've heard from the community and what we think that council has expressed that it wants. And we worked with Patty and the chief on this draft. I guess people who are here should have a copy of it. So the other thing we did is what we think should be next steps, but maybe we should take this one at a time, so.
Yeah. The only thing I'd add about the vision statement is that in our collaboration, and it's involved a lot of discussion and forums and meetings, was trying to come up with something that was more concrete so that it would tie into the mission and values that the police department has established, the Chief Hales has produced. And that's why, if you look at the document, we tried to add some examples and some other things to really hit at what kind of behaviors and philosophy would make sense for the village. So I think that is maybe why it doesn't look like just a one or two sentence sort of statement, but we tried to respond to things we heard at the work session, asking for clarity and more meaning behind what these concepts were about for the village.
And so there are four paragraphs that identify four different aspects. And the primary one is safety-centered. And in that paragraph, it identifies different ways that the police, that we want the police to be involved in the community promoting safety. And first, we acknowledge that most people in the community feel that this is a relatively safe community, regardless of the police, that the people in the community and the relationships in the community make it safe. There are particular things that the police do to enhance safety. And an example that's in this is, like, rather than setting up speed traps, a police will locate a car on Xenia Avenue, just as an example, to have people slow down. Then there was the concern that was brought up in some of the forums that some people do not feel safe with the police themselves. So how do we address that? And the main thing that we feel needs to happen is that the police officer police officers need to get to know the people in the community. The people in the community need to get the police off, need to know the police officers more. There needs to be more relationship building. That is one of the main things. The second bullet point is support oriented. And this is when someone does break the law, how are the police officers interacting with those people? It says here, compassionate, flexible, reasonable, and treat everyone fairly and consistently, which also means that people, they're not being treated based on race, ethnicity, how they dress, age, all of those factors. So that means that the police department needs to both respect diversity, but also needs to be educated and trained on dealing with diversity. The third bullet point is citizen focused, and this really gets more into what are different ways that the police department, individual officers, can engage with the community, and collaborative programs. For example, the police department working with the schools to have courses in the schools about rights and responsibilities. And the fourth is what we called locally minded, which means that the most of our officers now don't live in Yellow Springs. 40 years ago, everyone did. We can't expect officers now probably to live in Yellow Springs. We have, I think, two that do. And some of the dispatchers live in Yellow Springs. But what we do want is people that feel like they are part of the community. So finding ways that the officers can be engaging in the community. And on all of these points that I've just been talking about, Chief Hale has been working on having the department be learning how to do this. So do you want to say anything more?
No, that's great.
Does council want to respond?
As Mary Ann said, she and Brian and Chief and I all sat down and we basically hammered out not only, you know, a lot of the thoughts in this document, but ways to achieve some of the goals and to start working on some of these. And, you know, Chief and I agree that you know, these things, we need to make things change, but we hope people do understand it is going to take time to make some of these things change, because you have to change behavior, and changing behavior is not a simple thing. So it is going to take some time, and we just have to keep working at it until we get to where we want to be.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
And the Patty and the Chief, you said you're working on them, so mm-hmm. so the four areas mm-hmm. that Mary Ann discussed in her draft, mm-hmm. those are the four areas that you
correct.
Did you prioritize them? You know, because like you said, it's going to be somewhat of a long process.
I think you can work on them simultaneously. Okay. I don't think you necessarily have to prioritize them. For instance, one thing that came up at the last HRC meeting, which was Chrissy's idea, which was, I thought, such a great idea that I kind of went ahead and started towards implementing it, and it was coffee with a cop. And not just having a meet and greet where the officers are there in uniform, but having them go to, you know, the Emporium and Dino's and the Goat and sit down with people and have a cup of coffee and talk to people and not be in uniform, and so that they can get to know the the citizens, but then the citizens can get to understand that they're really just regular people trying to do a really difficult job, and sometimes they're going to do it right, and sometimes they're not going to do it so well, you know. But, you know, that was Chrissy's idea, and I thought it was a really good one. So I've already talked to two of the three coffee house owners, and they've agreed to help us implement that, and I think Brian is going to talk to the third one.
Mm-hmm. Great.
So, I mean, just things like that that we can work on simultaneously, and it seems like they're little things, but over time, they can change the attitudes on both sides of the street a little bit and make it a little better.
I do like this work a lot. I would love to have a one-line vision statement. I mean, I hate to say, I would like to have just a summary thing that could wrap it all up.
Well, and it can take those four, it can take those four concepts and and put those into a statement. I think that's a great idea.
Just so that this quick thing that people can look at.
Yep.
So we're done, Council. I want to be able to open the floor.
Well, I wanted to acknowledge a couple things. First of all, that maybe it's in our packet, I think, that mentions that three of the officers, including Chief Hale, have completed the 40-hour CIT training, which is crisis intervention training. And that was a training that was being recommended by HRC and the local NAMI chapter. Also, two of the officers have completed an 8-hour diversity training. So clearly, I think Chief Hale is working on having the department meet the desires of the community. And at the same time, I want to acknowledge that we know that racism exists. It exists in our community, and there have been a lot of things nationally that have been coming out more and more about ways that black people, especially black men, have been treated by police departments across the country. And that impacts us here. Whether it certainly impacts perceptions and different people. I mean, we've had African-American people tell us that they feel intimidated, let's say, by our police. So that's happening. I mean, I think we have to recognize that that's happening. What we want to do is work on that so that we are dealing with that situation.
Thanks.
And I want to say one more thing. I want to just clarify to Athena that I really heard what you're saying, and one of the binds we're in is that when there's a specific officer, it's difficult for us to even talk about the situation in a public forum. But I wanted to just make sure that we had expressed that what you said is concerning, and we want to not say anything that would hurt any future developments and hurt your ability to do what you need to do. But we definitely want you to feel safe in our community.
I'm wondering if I could just go through the next steps.
Sure.
And then we could open it.
Sure.
Then open it up. So the next steps that we feel that council should take, or that should be taken, are this year council make a decision on whether or not to stay in the ACE task force. And next year deal with some issues, how to use the mayor's court most effectively, evaluate whether it makes sense to keep the level of staffing at the police department the same or decrease it, and look at what kind of mechanisms can be most effective for resolving citizen concerns about the police. And then there are some other issues that may involve HRC, other organizations, and council, including collaborating with the police department to use Channel 5 to have educational material so people can understand, you know, what happens if you get stopped by a police officer? What should you do? What do you expect from them? Another thing is engage with groups like Black Lives Matter, to have a dialogue, and we're working on this, actually, as I speak. And then specifically, more engagement between the police department and youth. So those are the next steps that we see happening.
Thanks, Mary Ann and Brian. So we'll open it up to the floor, to citizens. Again, same rules apply. Come up to the microphone and 3 minutes. 3 minutes.
And be sure to state your name.
Chrissy, name, yes. Chrissy, go ahead. And if anybody wants to raise their hand, I'll start making a list.
And notice that there is a timer on the iPad that he just put up. For some reason, the other one isn't actually functioning. So, and you're...
Don't make little beating noises.
Yolanda? Okay, thank
okay,
you.
I'm Chrissy Cruz, and I just want to say real quick that Kate Hamilton messaged me, and I was a little bit confused. My suggestion was a community potluck with the police officers.
Oh,
it was
okay.
Kate Hamilton's suggestion,
oh,
coffee with...
Okay.
The cops.
I
want to give credit where credit is due. Mine was to have some kind of community gathering where the police officers could bring their families so we could see them. It was the same idea. So
right,
we could
right,
see
right.
them as people because we would meet their families and they would meet ours. And anyways, that's all I have.
Yeah. Thanks. Yolanda.
Yolanda.
I just want to go back to quickly. She said that they were working with Black Lives Matter. I was just curious, who would Black Lives Matter be working with?
It's, we actually, we called, Marianne spoke to Migawa, I've spoke to Bomani, and what we are hoping to do is have a sort of smaller group sit down with some village representatives and with representatives from Black Lives Matter.
So you should be hearing from Bomani, if you haven't, apparently
yeah.
you haven't already.
No, we have not.
And we just started. I spoke with Bomani on Friday. So, yeah.
Oh, so you just started.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of the things that we realize this is an issue that should be addressed now. And we listened a lot at the work session we had about, you know, the idea that we could take the lead as a community. Yellow Springs is known to be innovative, and we can be a role model in the region. And so we want to figure out how can we work together to address concerns.
I'm sorry, when you said that this is an issue that needs to be addressed, what exactly?
I'm sorry, but these issues, these concerns. So
concerns that she stated are concerns with Black Lives? Or
with Black Lives, okay, right.
And Black Lives and the treatment from the police? Okay.
Yes, we want to directly address that, and it seems like, you know, it's really important that we start that conversation.
Okay. And when you say you
excuse me, hold on a second.
Yolanda,
if you need
you
to
mind?
Come up, you need to, we don't have back and
no,
forth
okay.
dialogue,
okay.
so just come up.
You know,
okay.
Apparently you're just saying you need to address it, so that's what you just said.
Okay.
Are you guys, are there specific things that you want to address about Black Lives Matter and the police department?
I think we need to, I mean, that's what we want to sit down and,
okay,
and really hear from your group what we need to, you know, address and talk about.
Okay.
So anyway, so I mean, we really, I think I want to just be clear that, you know, we're not just trying to wordsmith and we're not just trying to, like, you know, make everything sound nice. We really want to address these issues. And what I'm really impressed by is that we have a chief and a village manager that's committed to this as well.
Right. Okay. And the interesting thing is that you made mention of the letter that was written in the Yellow Spring. I actually wrote the letter.
I know.
You know, and it's you took exception with the description. I take exception that you sort of demeaned and belittled my experience, and I think that that was unfair as well. So I hope that you are serious about addressing it because that was my experience.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Rose.
I'm Rose Pelzel. Looking through the budget documents in the packet this week, I was a little confused about why the was I just missing the police budget in there? And from the work session, it sounded like that council was planning on voting on the involvement in the ACE Task Force during the budget discussions, and I'm wondering this, you know, next step sounds like maybe that's changed a little bit, that it's being pushed back and not being part of the next couple meetings on the budget. And I also find the phrase in the vision, ensuring safety, problematic. I don't I don't know what safety means. And I don't know if we can task anyone to ensure anyone else's safety. But particularly when is a police budget going to be discussed, and is task force discussion going to happen during that or later?
Okay, thanks, Rose. We'll hold and answer questions at the end. Any other comments or questions? John?
I know I mentioned this at a previous meeting.
Can you state your name?
I'm sorry. I'm John Hempfling. I know that I mentioned this at a previous meeting, but I was thinking that one of the easiest ways that council could impact police practice would be to, state enforcement priorities and things that would be low enforcement priority. I don't know if that was under consideration at all.
Thanks, John. Anyone else? Ms. Jenkins? I know you have to do it again. Sorry. You have to come up here again. Sorry.
I'm glad that Ms. Cruz clarified the coffee with the cop idea, because as soon as it was said and where they were going to be held, the thought came to me that it would be best if they were in the communities and the neighborhoods over a period of time. And my reason for thinking that is because we're getting a lot of new people in the community, and some of them may not be outgoing, but if we come to the community and have the neighborhood coffee gathering at someone's house within that community, that might make them more comfortable and make the policeman more familiar with the different neighborhoods. So
that's certainly something that the chief and I can talk about. I mean, I think it's a great idea.
The neighborhoods, I mean, Chrissy in HRC has done such a great job with
the block parties.
The block parties of kind of getting those neighborhood groups together.
The same groups.
Yep.
So that's terrific.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, it would be nice even maybe to just have the police stop at those neighborhood parties. But, yeah, sorry, I just had a thought of that.
Well, yes, but we aren't going to have those again until next year.
Actually, there's like three of them this weekend.
Wow. Okay, so then they can start and then be ready next year. Okay. Mm-hmm. That sounds good. The other thing that concerns me is that I'd like to share with you is that it's not unusual to see foreclosed homes or foreclosed properties with overgrown grass. And sometimes they may cut the grass, but it's only in the front, and they don't do anything with the bushes and the trees. Mm-hmm. And we all know how neighboring homes can negatively impact other homes in that neighborhood. So I don't know whether the village has an ordinance or a law.
Yes, ma'am, we do. And in fact, we talked to a property company today about one down in your neighborhood.
Okay, because the bank, once they are foreclosed,
yes, ma'am,
the bank is supposed to be paying for the
lease. Right, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's right.
And I was wondering why the bank wasn't doing that.
Well, they're going to do it because they were told to today.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
Thank you.
And okay. Rose, I just want to tell you that the law enforcement of the public safety budget starts with Fund 212, and it goes through 213, 215, yeah. 216. So it is in there.
It is odd that the 212 has zero for general operating expenses, zero for.
Wait, no.
Let's.
Okay. At any rate, so I might want to just.
What was the
Start at 212.
It's on page 48 of the packet.
And then to clarify the time frame that Rose was asking, I actually thought that we were prioritizing the ACE decision this quarter.
Or, right.
Well, not maybe not this quarter, this but 2015.
Yes. That's in the next steps.
Right, okay. And that will be in 2015. And it has budgetary implications. Are you recommending that we talk about it separately than directly in the budget?
Right, right.
But it may have budgetary implications.
Yeah, we talked about that at the work session, actually, because I think there was some confusion.
That's not what was said.
Right. The ACE Task Force, I mean, there's a budgetary consideration, but it's its own topic that we will, you know, highlight on the agenda and discuss. So.
During the budgetary discussion?
It'll be during the next couple months.
Okay.
I mean, the budgetary discussions will be ongoing.
Okay.
And this will happen.
Right.
And this will happen before the budget is finally approved, if that helps.
Right. Any other comments or questions? I guess, do we want to?
Well, I do.
Oh, okay.
Christy talked about there are 8 more
block parties.
But the last one of them are Circle and Paxton Drive and Talis Drive did include a very large section of the African American community.
Mm-hmm.
So as you plan,
mm-hmm.
We'll have to work with that group get the officers back because we've had our block party.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Absolutely.
And I just want one more thing directed to Rose again. So, Rose, your comment from the work session about defining safety was, you know, guided us in thinking about being more concrete. So I would love your ideas about that. This is a work in progress. So
we're not going to, I know that there was a
draft resolution.
Resolution to approve this, so we'll just hold
on
that.
Just to kind of see what it might look like.
Okay.
Because I think one thing that Mary Ann and I wanted was feedback from other council members about how do we sort of, you know, pass this, you know,
okay.
Is it kind of, does it have a resolution attached and so on?
So.
Yeah, but we do have to be careful if that it's more than one communication with one of you, because if we start
No, well, that's why we're doing it now.
Right. So, so I think we've laid out the general schedule time frame. We'll get into specifics at the end of the meeting when we get into when we might take this up again, when we get into agenda planning.
Was there? There was.
Chrissy, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
We have scheduled one for September the 6th because I was looking at the plans for the block parties. I noticed there are a lot of neighborhoods where they don't really have block parties yet. So on September the 6th, we're going to be having one right downtown on Winter Street,
mm-hmm.
between Winter and Dayton and Elm. And that's going to be pretty much a block party for anybody that didn't have a block party or just anybody that wants to come. It's the block party for the whole village, the whole shebang. So that will be September the 6th. And that's almost the last one except for one that's being held late in September. But anyways, this is like a community one for people that
Oh, great. My neighborhood's on the 19th.
I still think the point that Jerry, it's a good point. I'm glad you brought it up. But I think it would be good to have some kind of a special police coffee in the Omar Circle,
mm-hmm.
Talis Drive
mm-hmm.
area. So maybe we can make that happen.
Rose
got one more.
One more con.
Not revenue, expense.
Yeah, that might be the problem. Yeah.
Okay. Now we're moving on. Speaking
page
of budget,
22 of the expense
to our soon-to-be assistant village manager and finance director, Melissa Van Zandt. What we asked for her to do in preparation for discussing the budget for 2016, and also in recognizing that we will be going back to ask the voters for support again on the levy in 2016, in May of 2016. We've asked to do, you know, kind of a back to basics look at the budget, revenue sources, what other options we might have for raising revenues, and to kind of look at where we are and what the future holds. So I will turn it over to Melissa. She's getting ready, it looks like.
I've got a PowerPoint and the printouts, I think Judy provided you all with mm-hmm. two slides on the page.
Excuse me a second. Do we want to take a few minute break while Melissa yeah. sets up?
That would work.
Hey,
okay.
That'd be
yeah,
great.
It'll take me a second.
I like that jacket. You're welcome.
Sorry. Okay, Melissa, I think we're all here now.
Good to go?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, so council wanted me to do an overview on revenues, where we get them from, and then also look at a couple of different options where we might be able to increase revenues, where we do have some flexibility or some options for flexibility. And then talk about the levy. So it's kind of a all over the place presentation, but I hope it's helpful. I'm going to try to keep it really brief. I did not get this into the council packet because some of the information that I needed came from Rita and it came late on Friday. So therefore the PowerPoint was not in the packet, but if anybody needs it, I can email it to them. The council was provided with hard copies of this.
I don't have a copy.
Okay, who at the table doesn't have a copy?
Just me?
Nope. Okay, so we need three up here.
It's showing something totally different up there than what I was seeing.
Thank you.
Okay, well, we'll see what happens.
Does everybody else?
I got
all right.
Maybe it's asleep. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're just going to do a quick run through of the general fund and where we get our money from. The money that goes into the general fund is non-restrictive. That means that we can transfer it out to other funds. That's usually where bulk of our expenses go every year. We transfer them out to streets funds. Or streets and parks to support those because they have very little money coming in. So we do have flexibility within the general fund. Approximately 70% of what comes into the general fund is a result of local taxes that we receive, which are property and income taxes. This thing was working perfectly earlier. Okay, here we go. So when we look at the budget and we look at the revenue report, it's broken into different categories. These are the major categories that we receive money from. We get money from local taxes, which, like I said, are the property and income taxes. We also get money from kilowatt hour tax, which comes from our electric utility, which is received in every month. It's about $11,000 a month or something that we get from that. We also get our state shared taxes and permits. Comes from gas tax, motor vehicle tax, things like that. We also have fines, costs, forfeitures, and permits. Most of that money is brought in by the mayor's court, and then the little bit of money that we get from permitting comes in too. And then we also have miscellaneous receipts and reimbursements, and that's kind of all over the place. That's where most of our rent comes in from our rental properties. Anytime we sell a property, that's where that money comes in as well. The insurance premiums that employees pay back in go into that, and our cable franchise fees go in there too. So it's kind of like a slush fund that we have. This thing is not reacting as quickly as what it should.
Will okay. the arrows
work? It might work, but well, it might work better with the little handheld thing too.
Mm. Where is the handheld thing?
It's right there.
This thing? Well, let's see what happens.
Mm. No.
Okay, well, we're just gonna be really patient with this thing, I guess. Okay, so this is just giving us an overall historical view of the general fund revenues as a whole. So that takes it back from 2008 to the year end of 2014. And as you can see, it kind of dips, it ebbs and flows as it goes along. And some of the following slides that you'll see will kind of help define what's happened. These are our local tax trends, which basically mirrors the entire general fund because obviously 70% of it is composed of the local taxes, which again are the property taxes, the income taxes, and the kilowatt hour taxes, those three. So they do ebb and flow, and this does mirror the very first slide that we had. The next one that we're going to look at is actual property taxes, and it's going to compare that to the levy effect. So the top line is what our property taxes look like with the levy, and they're relatively flat. The bottom line is what our property taxes would look like should we not have the levy. The levy contributes approximately $730,000 or so of our total property tax dollars. So as you can see, they are relatively flat, but the levy makes a huge difference in those figures. And if we look at our state shared taxes and permits, most of this is driven by our state taxes and local government fund monies. As you can see, in 13 into 14, that was when the estate tax went away, and we've got that huge dip there, which I'm going to illustrate on the next slide as well. Estate taxes are in the red. Those are very unpredictable when we were receiving them, but now those have totally went away. And actually, we had more money taken out of our first quarter or our first half distribution from the county auditor because we were overpaid in a prior year. So they got us for like $12,000 of overpayment this year. So
what, from estate tax or yeah, local government?
It was from estate tax. We were overpaid from somebody, and in our first half distribution, we had a huge hit, and I had to call them. I was like, what is this? And they said, well, you got overpaid, and they gave me the name of the individual whose estate it was, and
can I
had
ask
to give it back. So
back in the previous slide, you've got from 2014 into 2015, you've got the line going up. I mean, it's not a lot, but a little bit. Why is that? The line for shared taxes and permits.
I'd have to look at the entire revenue report to see what other driver could have been contributing to that, because I mean, it's not a lot of money to begin with, so I'd have to look at the revenue report to try to identify the one that might have been driving that one.
Well, I'm going to guess gas taxes.
Gas taxes really haven't changed. They've stayed fairly flat, so I'd have to look at the revenue report to see which one might have been the driver behind that one.
Okay.
But as you guys can see, the estate tax and the local government fund, the local government fund has taken a dip, but it's not a drastic dip, so I mean, it's still on a downward trend though, which is one of the topics that have been brought up recently. Fines, costs, forfeitures, permits. This is mostly money that's received from the mayor's court. That's the big driver behind this one. And this is just mostly mayor's court with this one, so it's not a huge amount of money to begin with. I mean, it was like $75,000, and now it's down to $30,000 over the last, 7 years here. So there's a number of contributing factors to that, which everybody's kind of looked at when it comes to the mayor's court and things. Okay, miscellaneous receipts and reimbursements. Again, this one is kind of all over the place. It's got our cable franchise fees, like I said, rent, insurance premiums from employees. It's got property sales. That's why there was a little bit of a spike going into 15, was because there were a couple of lots the one lot on Cemetery Street contributed to that. So it's kind of all over the place as well. Just depends on the year and what's going on. Sometimes we get large reimbursements for something that we could have paid out, so that's the story behind those. This next little section is really going to be what's going to be important, and I want to draw everybody's attention to. When we start to think about what we could do to possibly increase our general fund revenues, we really have two options, and that's to tweak our income tax or to tweak our property taxes. The only way that you can tweak an income tax is to reduce reciprocal or increase the rate. And what reciprocal is we have a 1.5% income tax rate. If somebody lives in the village and they work in the city of Dayton, and the city of Dayton's property or income tax is only 1%, they would pay Dayton 1%, they would pay us the other 0.5%. However, if they work somewhere where the income tax rate is higher, like 2%, we wouldn't get anything. It would all go to the city in which they work in. So the reciprocal right now is at 100%. We give credit for 100% of our 1.5% to people that work outside of the village. And again, our rate is 1.5%. And then with the property taxes, the only way that we can try to increase those is to levy those dollars. And right now we do have the levy, which will run out at the end of 2016, which has been quite the topic lately, which we'll talk about in a little bit as well.
Melissa, can I just ask about the income tax? So, I mean, are there any limits on, you know, increasing our income tax or?
Yep, that's where we're going to go right now.
Thank you.
Okay, so our income tax is approximately 48% of our general fund revenues. And in our ordinance, it allows us to forgive the income tax payable to us for people that work elsewhere at 100% rate. So I'm gonna show you guys some of the differences some of the different revenue options should we decide to tweak that. Again, we're at 1.5% income tax rate, which is about the middle. I looked at all the income tax rates all over the state of Ohio, and 1.5% is pretty much smack dab in the middle. You got everyone from either 0% income tax all the way up to 3%. 1.5% is pretty common. We can amend both of these, and the way that we would amend them are by two different actions. If we reduced our credit or the forgiveness, that can be done by council action. If we were to change our rate, that can only be changed by a vote of the residents. And I thought that it was interesting also to note that when I did talk to Rita, they did indicate that 40% of our residents live and work in the village, and that's about 10 to 15% higher than most communities. So the largest tax base comes from our residents, so should we decide to tweak the rate in the forgiveness, we're just going to have to try to figure out a balance for that in order. Go ahead, Patty.
I just have a question. When you said that the rate could only be changed by a vote of the residents, right now we're at 1.5%. Council could raise it to 1.75 without a vote, couldn't they? Is 2% or higher that's a
has I'm to not be? Sure. When I was talking to the folks at Rita, they told me that if we changed the rate, it had to be by a vote. Now, okay. I don't know if there's a cap on, you know, yeah, the percentage. Chris? That would have to go out to vote or not.
I thought it was 2% or higher, but I could be wrong. Well,
I think it's anything.
Look
honestly.
A little bit more. Yeah. It sounds like mm-hmm. this is probably right, but it might not hurt to double check.
Mm-hmm. And then we have property tax options as well. The current levy, it's providing about $735,000 a year. And what I would like to do, let me see. I do want to draw your attention to one of the documents that I had in here that was a five-year budget projection for the general fund, and it compares the levy without the levy, and this was put into the packet, and it gives a five-year projection of what our general fund revenues and expenses would look like with and without that levy. And I based that on $700,000 worth of revenue, so I was being very conservative with it. And basically, in a nutshell, with the levy, we would, at the end of 2020, add about $122,000 to our reserves.
120.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I'm trying to find the page you're talking about.
Okay.
It's 120 in the packet, apparently.
Oh, is it? Yeah, I don't know the page number.
It's a big packet. 173 pages this time.
It's all
so
financials, yeah, that really drives it.
It does.
Okay, so if you look at the top portion of that sheet, it shows that, you know, we would have a slight deficit in 16, a slight deficit in 17, and then we would add to our reserves by about $122,000 by 2020. That's assuming that our income taxes are going up by about $100,000 a year, which has been the trend. So that's what I'm figuring it off of. So with the levy, we're only adding to our reserves a very small amount through 2020. So it's really not enough to be able to do some of the things that Patty and I were talking about doing, which is investing in some of those capital funds, or those capital funds for facilities and for streets and for parks and for things like that. So if we want to continue to invest in some of those capital improvement budgets, for our streets and our parks and things like that, green space, we're going to have to do something in order to provide some more revenues. And then if you look at the bottom part of this, the general fund without the levy, if you look out to 2020, we would be at a negative fund balance of $1.6 million if we continue to spend the way that we do without those levy dollars. So that just shows how important the levy is to what we're doing. It doesn't mean that the levy is the only option that we have, but if we didn't have that as an option, then we would have to plug that hole some other way, which is where this next slide is going to kind of show us what options for income tax we would have. So what we have on the left is we have the current rate, and it provides about $1.6 million on track for this year. It was up a little bit higher than what I projected at this point in the year. So about $1.6 million. If we raise that to 2%, it would give us an additional $511,000 a year, which is pretty significant. And that raising the rate is the more immediate impact that we would see because it affects employer withholdings, and we get those a lot faster. If we changed the credit, which would be by council action.
You mean the reciprocal?
The reciprocal. Currently at 100%, we get nothing from anybody that works outside of the village. If we reduce that to 75%, that would generate $120,500 a year. If we reduced it to 50%, it would give us $241,000, and then I take you all the way down to, if we reduced it all the way to zero, you pay us no matter how much you have to pay the municipality that you work in. So when I first started talking to the folks at RITA, they said, what are you looking for? And I said, well, if we had to get around $700,000 or so to kind of, you know, compensate for the levy, should something happen with the levy, or we decide to go a different direction, or whatever the case may be, we assign that levy to something completely different, how could we make up for that by tweaking our income tax? And basically what they said is, in order to get to that, as close to that amount as we could, which would be about $800,000, we would have to raise our rate to 2% and then do a 50% forgiveness or credit on that reciprocal. So as you can see, I mean, we've got a number of options. You can use them together, you can use them separately. I didn't run any figures on if we would have changed the rate to 1.75. They were just trying to give me a good starting point in order to try to get to that magic number that I was kind of looking for. Mm-hmm. So this is going to be really good food for thought moving forward. In looking at the side-by-side comparison of what our five-year projection is, even with the levy, I think that we're going to have to make some sort of a change. That's going to be up to council what you guys want to do, but these are the approximate amounts that we could get. However, if we do change the credit, it takes a little bit longer to realize that than what it does to just flat out change the rate, because we get the withholdings from the employers on a monthly basis, and we get that money a lot faster than what we would if we would have changed the reciprocal.
And when do you get the reciprocal?
End of the year, people, kind of thing?
Usually when people file.
Yeah, it's usually when people file, and
unless they pay less.
And when you deal with net profit withholding, it's kind of skewed because it could be a year or two after the year in which they are claiming that we would actually realize it, which was part of the reason our income taxes spiked quite a bit last year. It was like $250,000 or something from YSI that we got, because their net withholdings or their net profit was way more than what it should have been, because they always base it off of estimates, and sometimes those estimates come in higher or lower, and then we realize that. But they were very cautious to tell me once I started probing into that extra money that we got, not to bank on that, because it can fluctuate wildly. So sometimes when we actually get the money, it could be from a year or two prior. So,
and I did look it up, and it is a maximum of 1% without voter approval. So
1%.
Anything
over 1%. Yeah. Is. And I have another question then. Do we know, like, what are the practices of neighboring communities? Are they, like, is it standard to do the 100% for the reciprocal? Is it?
I haven't compared to see.
I think it varies.
I think most communities in this region are 100% reciprocal. They are moving away from it. I know Oakwood tried to, and it did not go over very well.
Springboro has 100%.
And I think Riverside is looking into changing theirs. It as all of our revenues are diminishing, every community is looking at this kind of thing. So
right.
I think we're going to see it more and more.
Well, I appreciate this, because honestly, yeah. This is the first I've heard of this. I've been on council for 7 years.
You didn't know about reciprocal?
Well, I didn't know we could change it.
Oh, wow.
I always was under the impression that the only thing we could do was alter property taxes. Right. This has
like
never
to give
been
a shout out to Henry Myers, because he's been talking about this.
Well,
he
has mentioned it,
year.
But when he's come in, he hasn't said this exactly. And plus, I was under the impression from what previous people had told me, perhaps I'd misinterpreted, that we couldn't change it at all.
Right.
I mean if we're talking about changing the rate, though, I mean, I think that has to go hand in hand with the economic development discussion. Mm-hmm. And will increasing that rate have a negative impact on economic development? Because the other thing that you didn't say is that we actually can increase revenue by increasing jobs and having more income tax.
That's true. But in terms of flexibility that we have and control that we have with, you know, the money that we have coming in current present day, this is about all we've got. I mean, if we expect everything to stay flat and assume that it's going to be, this is the flexibility that we have.
And obviously, property development can also, is another source.
Yeah, with property tax.
If we develop the glass farm, that's a lot more property tax that would be coming in, for instance. Right. Parts of the glass farm.
I have a question. We have to change the income tax ordinance because of House Bill 5.
Correct.
Before the end of the year. Is that going to have any impact on the revenue that you collected by the village?
I don't think it's going to change the revenue a whole lot.
No.
It's just, if anything, it's going to actually reduce it a little bit.
Yeah, it was going to have very minuscule effect on us. I had them run the figures, and I mean, it wasn't really worth much.
Right.
It would affect us, but it wasn't worth much.
So, Melissa, I agree, is great. And I just want to make sure we're all clear. So, you know, obviously, if we increase the, you know, rate, then that has a clear effect on taxpayers. When we lower the reciprocal, that also has an effect, right? Because if, you know, so I guess basically, like, given the date scenario, so if we reduced ours to 50%, then that means that the taxpayer has got to pay that extra chunk out.
But
right?
No, actually, with Dayton, I don't think they still would. Dayton's 2.25, so.
Well.
All right, but you mentioned 1.5,
right.
1.5.
Yeah. I was totally making that up.
Right.
I have no idea what
So, but in that scenario, if we lower, you know, our reciprocal, then that sort of adds
it's
to.
It's the taxpayer that
yeah.
Right. Make it
yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So it would affect any of our residents that work outside of the village, which is 60% based on RITA. They said it was 40% live and work in the village, which is 10 to 15% higher than other communities. So they were actually very surprised when they gave me that number. So this is just going to be really good food for thought and moving forward with budget discussions. I'm just going to talk really quickly about enterprise funds, because when Wayne Cannon comes in, he's going to give us tons of information on rate increases and things like that. Basically, your enterprise funds, those monies are restricted. You can't move them out unless you have a court order. They're all received from charges for service. They should always be enough to cover your costs, plus allow to have some money to be able to move into like capital improvement funds, which we are trying to institute, which is good. Regular rate increases. With water, you guys had it set up where you guys were doing, there was an ordinance where there were gonna be regular water rate increases for a while, but there wasn't anything in existence with any of the other utilities.
Right.
So it's kind of been plugging the holes as you go along, except for the electric fund. So this, I think, and I hope Wayne Cannon shows you, which I know that this is super small, but basically what this slide, I thought that this slide was like mind-blowing when I seen it, when he showed this to Patty and I. This shows that if you charge everybody a dollar base rate and you've got 10 customers, so in year one, you collect a dollar from everybody, you got 10 bucks. If you increase that by 3%, at the end of 7 years, you'd have $76 worth of an accumulated balance. If you do nothing for 4 years, in order to get the same amount in year five from that regular 3% increase, you would have to raise rates 31%.
Yeah.
If you do nothing for 5 years, in order to get to that same amount, let's see, yeah, if you do nothing for, no, it's 6 years actually, that was a typo. If you do nothing for 6 years in order to get to that same figure from that top slide where you're adding 3% every single year, you would have to raise rates 47% to get to that same end result.
Yeah.
And then if you do nothing for 6 years in order to, or it's 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's waiting 6 years if you include
right.
the standard rate for the first year, that's what it is. If you wait 6 years in order to do a rate increase to get to that same bottom line where if you would have just done it 3% every single year, you would have to increase it 67%. This just illustrates that if you do not do regular rate increases, you are going to have to recover by just killing customers with huge rate increases. So this is something that Wayne Cannon is going to talk about, but I just wanted to bring it up just when we go into budget talks.
We just need ordinances that just implement them.
Just small incremental mm-hmm. increases are going to save us in the long run. It just needs to be something that we do every year, because if we don't and we wait 6 years, we're going to have to slam them with a 67% rate increase, and nobody's going to be able to swallow that one.
Right.
So I just wanted to show you guys that. That was my last slide there in the presentation. I did have a history of major fund balances that shows the general fund and our different operating funds, because I know that council did want to know kind of what's the difference between 2015 and 2016, because you know the picture was painted a little bit better. Basically, 2015 we're on track to go into deficit by $148,000, which was a lot less than what was predicted, because we've got that extra money that was transferred out to support the loop completion coming back in. Also, our expenditures have just been down, so we're only set to go into deficit by $148,000, and our beginning balance was $1.9 million. Next year, I'm predicting it's only going to be $21,000, because I've minimized the transfers that are going out to streets and parks and trying to spend down some of the reserves that are in those funds. Those are not the improvement funds, those are the operating funds. So that's going to help out the general fund tremendously. The electric operating fund, the only reason that there's a large deficit projected for 2016 is because we were going to move out $500,000 into a capital improvement fund, and really bringing that up since we've got a pretty healthy fund balance in the electric. So really they would have been adding to their fund balance versus going into a deficit, but transferring that big amount out into a capital
right.
improvement fund is what's doing that. The water operating fund, we're going to finish in the black this year and in next year. That does not include anything with the new water plant, but it does include what we expect to spend for the loop completion and for the bottleneck. But those have been rate increases that we've already tried to get ahead of the game and try to build those up a little bit. The sewer fund, I had projected another 15% increase coming for 2016 to get us into the black. So that would give us a fund balance of $22,000 at the end of the year. And then trash is pretty easy. It's in and out. We've been deficit spending for a little bit. And 15, we're going to end up in the black, and 16 as well, by very small amounts, because it's just basically a regular in and out.
Mm-hmm.
So in a nutshell, in 2015, we were dealing with full transfers out. We were dealing with trying to plug the hole in the water fund in order to get those projects going and paying for the consultants and things like that. So 2015 was kind of a hard year in terms of that, because the water fund was doing so poorly. But 16, with minimizing those transfers, getting some rate increases in there for the enterprise funds, I think that we're going to be in better shape. But we also have the levy that we can rely on, and we're still going to have to look at some other source of supplemental revenue for the general fund in order to be able to build up some of those improvement funds that desperately need some money in them because we've almost drained all of them. Facilities and Parks and Rec, we've really spent down almost all of them. So that's what I have for you guys today. I do have, I had totally forgotten about the levy timeline, but this was something that I did a couple meetings ago, and I had Judy disseminate that again. Council did decide trying to look at the levy and get it on the November ballot for this year was not something that they wanted to do. So all of these dates are still good. I checked with the Board of Elections. So this at least gives us a starting point to be able to look at kind of deadlines and things that we have in order to be able to get the levy on the May ballot and then November ballot should we need it a second time or should it decide to be pushed off until November, whatever you guys decide.
Right, and you also have additionally another iteration of the information from CUPA in case we decide, CUPA, in case we decide we want to do a survey. Citizen survey on the levy.
On the levy? Mm-hmm.
The one thing I would say is that I think this timeline for the levy that we need to have those three resolutions on December 21st, we at least need to hear those resolutions, approve those resolutions, and then the new council will have to deal with the, I guess. I mean, if.
Yeah, that seems fine. I don't see why we couldn't do that.
Maybe we can even do both of them. Let's look into see how that works in our schedule. Great job, Melissa.
Thank you. That was really helpful.
And you did it quickly too. Thanks.
Yeah, you did great.
So, council, are we?
I think
lots to think about, but ready to move on.
Yep.
Okay.
Did you want Melissa to go over the fund options? Lori had asked that she bring information on the payment options.
Utilities.
She sent me a nice long email. I'm fine with it.
Okay.
And maybe we can talk about it some other time. It's too late. Nobody's here.
I did a whole payment option thing outlining everything. I'll put it on the website.
That'll be great.
Yeah, that was great.
And then I can just put that in an email and tell people to go look there.
You are such an overachiever.
She is.
I'll get it on the website.
Great. I told you she works circles around everybody.
Yes. And we did just take the work session review off the agenda for one where we don't have a lot else going on. So I guess next is the last in new business is the Clean Ohio grant.
Yeah. So Tom Dietrich is going to make the presentation, and I would just like to say that we had met with Krista and also talked with Patty, but Krista has indicated that Clean Ohio has a fair amount of money in the fund for natural areas as opposed to farmland easements.
Ah. Mm-hmm.
And it's the same kind of grant that they got to do the remediation along the Yellow Springs Creek right outside here, which is the same creek, essentially, the same body of water that we're talking about. So, turn it over to Tom.
Okay, thanks. Thank you for the opportunity to talk about this. Tom Dietrich, I'm a villager and Environmental Commission member. So as Marianne mentioned, came to our attention that there was grant funds available to help preserve the Glass Farm Conservation Area. I provided a figure that indicates the first figure shows the whole of the Glass Farm property and that the conservation area, actually the project area is just 7 or 8 acres, I think it's 7.4 acres approximately, portion of that, so it's the eastern portion that this project is proposed for. The project is, The proposal is similar to the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation grant, the proposal that we've provided before, and which, as a reminder, we're removing invasive species, doing some restoration, implementing the beaver management plan, adding some trails, providing better access to villagers, potentially a handful of parking spaces and bike rack, access off of King Street. No change to current land use or zoning, and the application's due October 31st, and the total, the approximate budget we're looking at is around $75,000. That's for the total project. There's a 25% matching requirement in this grant, which could come from donations or in-kind volunteer service or from potentially green space funds. So we are currently working with a local resident or a interested donor that could help provide some funds. And we definitely have a bunch of volunteers and others, organizations that could help provide the in-kind match. The second figure I didn't talk about, but it shows a little more detail about some conceptual trails, the conceptual areas for the restoration. It shows the community gardens on there that may or may not be part of the easement. We haven't completely determined the exact definition of where the easement line would go. Oh, and I didn't mention the easement, which would be a part of this project, and would be held by Tecumseh Land Trust. So they have been a partner in this. They're the ones who brought the grant funds to our attention through our collaboration with them. So that's the general outline of the, and we just wanted to bring it to you for information and answer any questions you have. We plan to come back at the September 8th council meeting to provide a proposal and to talk about, to answer any more detailed questions and address any concerns.
So Tom, I just have a quick
yes.
question. So where you list grant activities, develop a long-term maintenance plan, that does include the beaver management?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes. What will our actions be that we would need to do?
We would have to pass a resolution. First of all, we'd have to enter into an agreement like we did an easement with Tecumseh Land Trust, and then we'd have to pass a resolution supporting the application for the grant. We can apply for it ourselves and allow them to administer it. That wouldn't be a problem.
So when would that be? I just want to get it on the count.
You just need to pass the resolution before the date, which is October 31st.
October 31st.
The grant application deadline is October 31st.
Yeah, so I would do it.
The grant requires you to acquire the easement within 12 months.
Right.
So it doesn't have to occur before the application, just to be clear.
Yeah, I mean, we can pass the resolution saying we're going to apply for it, okay. And then just like we did for the property back here.
Okay. Penny, what does that do to our retention pond?
It's actually, Jason and I talked about this before, because we knew this discussion was coming up because I had gotten notified about the grant, and we both agree that the device is working properly. It doesn't look so great right now because there's a lot of debris against
it. No, I'm not talking about the beaver device. No, I'm talking about
the actual pond, detention pond.
Because we set that up as a retention pond.
Right.
And,
It's still functioning as that.
No, but, because I kind of looked at the map and they talked about trails and so
right.
forth. See, my concern is the front of the retention pan
right.
where the pipe runs over, and we've kind of made that with permeable rock and so forth that
right.
sit down and go. And it, to me, it doesn't get a whole lot of room in to have a...
It has actually increased the retention area slightly above and beyond what it was supposed to be. And as far as the amount of water that it actually is functioning a little bit better. And the reason I say that is because the device is working and it's allowing that pipe, if it needs to operate at full capacity. So the only time that water is going to flood up over the road is when it's going to flood up over the road anyway, whether that was there or not, because that device is allowing that pipe to actually function at the 36 inches that it's supposed to function at.
I'll talk to you offline about
it does seem we may need to have some civil engineering
of whatever the final plan is, just to have somebody look at it and...
Well, I think that actually the donor that Tom briefly mentioned is going to work with Jason on...
And I've just heard from him, too.
Yeah, is going to work. Yeah.
But is there a certified engineering design? That's what I'm waiting to hear.
Well, Karen, what we're talking about is essentially a fence.
But let's back up.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, there is, because we're only putting it back the way John Eastman designed it to be.
Okay, okay.
So, yes, there is an engineer that worked on it, and it's going to be essentially back like John designed it to be.
Okay.
So just to be clear, that part is not part of the grant.
Right.
That part needs to occur no matter if we get the grant or not. The
right.
fence that was
Correct.
Installed is not, has been damaged.
It's not sturdy enough.
Needs to be replaced.
Okay.
No matter. I just wanted to add on one thing, not actually about the glass farm itself, but when Patty brought the grant to my attention, her idea was to be working from Dayton Street to the glass farm, that stream that goes through the Baptist mm-hmm. Church and
to get
the five properties
easements.
There. When we met with Krista and Michelle, they said, Clean Ohio won't work for that, what you want to do there. But they said,
Ohio Soil and Water.
Because what we would like to do as another step is to be able to get into that area where trees and trash and stuff have fallen, clean out that debris, clean out the invasive vegetation, shore up. But that means dealing with private property owners.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So that would be another step.
So this project is only intended to be on the village property,
yeah.
the glass farm.
Okay. Well,
so just so we can push, you know, give these folks approval or at least agreement at this point that we're supportive of the project, and I guess you'll be coming back at another meeting.
Yes.
So we have at least a couple more
meeting.
Steps.
Right.
So I move that we have a resolution brought for this to the next meeting.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Thank you.
See, it was worth the wait.
Okay. Manager and assistant manager reports.
You have my written report. I just need to cover three things really quickly. The Utility Dispute Resolution Board, we need to get that back up and running. I've outlined the procedure that I think would be what I would recommend to council that we follow, which is to take resumes and letters of interest that like we do for most of the others and let council review and make appointments. So it is something that's required by our ordinance that somehow fell through the cracks. I have no idea when, but it is something that we need to reinstitute, and I'd like to have it in place by the first of the year.
So related to that, Patty, then we should, I guess, select two council members that would do that.
Right, that two council members, and I'd like to have some input as well.
So this is the citizen?
Yeah, the Utility Dispute Resolution Board consists of myself, Melissa, Johnny Burns, and two residents appointed by council.
Oh,
is
okay.
how it's made up in the ordinance.
Sound like Marianne and Jerry, maybe?
Wait a minute. She said two residents.
Yeah,
we still have to interview
two council
them.
People need to interview the residents.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, I'll see
you.
Okay.
Okay. So we will get that process started. The other thing is I was contacted by a resident who wants us to put the no bikes on the sidewalk markers back up. We don't necessarily have to discuss it right now, but council needs to think about whether you would like to have them painted back on the sidewalks, which are brand new and really hesitant to do that because they just wear off anyway, or put signs actually up downtown, which I'm also hesitant to do because of the clutter. So those are the things that council can weigh and decide. I mean, we can discuss it now if you'd like, or we can save it for the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we need to save it because you really didn't give us any options.
I said I was hesitant to recommend them. I mean, if I had to go with one, I'd choose the signs, but you do have to think about sign clutter because Jason's getting ready to put those poles back in the holes for the thing. So it is something that you need to think about. And the last thing I'd like to talk about is the tree beds downtown.
and how the mulch tends to wash out of them, especially the ones over on Xenia Avenue. And you will see a brief in your packets about this problem and the two potential solutions, which are tree grates and permeable pavers. Jason and I met with Anita Brown, Roger Beal, and Karen about this problem. And I think we all, at the end of the day, agreed that the permeable pavers were the better option for a couple of reasons, primarily the ones that are, you know, they can remove a row at a time and still keep it looking uniform. They're less expensive. They're permeable so that the water does get down to the tree roots. High heels, I don't wear them, but they'll get stuck in the tree grates. And it makes a nice solid surface for folks getting out of their car. So this is something we kind of like to get moving on before street fair. So if council is so inclined, the chamber has offered to do all of the trees along the eastern side of Xenia, and then we could continue to do them as we finish up streetscape and eventually get Dayton Street done as well.
Well,
So discussion?
I'd probably go with the tree grates, but that's just me. I don't like the idea of not covering the entire bed. What does that mean, not cover the entire bed?
It would be, it would kind of be like you have an oblong tree bed, mm-hmm. Like this, and the tree is here, and it would essentially make a three, because it's 3.5 feet wide, so it would make it 3.5 by 3.5 square. These would be pavers, and these would be pavers, and this would be open.
Right.
But it would be a smaller space.
Right. I think I'm still in the same place. I think I would probably go with tree grates myself. I think there's a little less of a trip hazard.
Now, you did have the tree grates, Patty.
Similar.
The tree grates were, Trisha, it'd be the same diagram that you showed.
No, the tree grates are actually, they come in two pieces, and they would fit up to the trunk of the tree. They would have a cutout, and then they would be, they would have open areas, kind of like a honeycomb pattern, and you would just trim them back as the tree grows, so you'd have to consistently cut the grate. It's like a polymer kind of grate kind of thing, rubber.
Right, so it's kind of a thick rubber that water flows right through them.
Yeah.
When you say more expensive, what are we talking about?
The tree grates, because we have an unusual size of tree bed, would be around $700 a piece. I think.
Oh. And how much would the permeable pavers
be? About half that cost.
Wow. I don't know. It seems like I would go with, did you mean that the chamber would pay for
The chamber has offered to pay to do the permeable pavers on all of the trees on the east side of Xenia that we put in as part of the last two phases of
streetscape. So the chamber actually prefers the permeable pavers?
They do.
Okay. I guess I could go with permeable pavers then. See how easy I am.
The permeable pavers will widen the sidewalk a little bit too.
Yeah. So what, you guys have feelings?
I'm fine with the pavers.
Yeah, I agree with what you're saying, but half the cost matters to me. I mean, I don't know.
Because eventually it's likely that the village may end up having to do the rest of the trees.
Right.
Other thing would be put them in on one tree and see what it's like.
Yeah, but I think that's going to slow up the process, because this is a continuing process. I mean, problem.
It's kind of a right now problem, and it needs to be solved right now. Let's just do the permeable pavers.
Mm-hmm. So consensus of council is pavers? Okay. That's all I have.
Yep.
Okay.
All right. So there will be a planning commission meeting next Monday at 7 o'clock. The agenda is listed below. It has not changed from last week. Mm-hmm. Scott Sears' last day is tomorrow as the intern.
Okay.
So we'll be sending him off tomorrow. And then my last day is the 4th. Denise will be, I guess, next Monday. She'll be down in my office being trained. And I just want to congratulate both Melissa and Denise on moving up, and I think they'll both do an amazing job. So I've enjoyed working here with you guys, and I hope that you guys keep in touch in the future. I definitely plan on stopping by the village.
Please do.
Mm-hmm. And telling the story here.
Early and often.
Really good. Yes. So.
And please don't forget that John's going away reception is Thursday at 2:30, and there will be cake. There will be chocolate cake.
We're talking about this Thursday.
2:30 till what time? Because I teach until pretty close to that time.
Well, probably 4-ish.
Sure.
I mean, we'll be hanging out and talking, and we'll save you a piece of cake.
Let me put that on my calendar.
2:30, you said?
2:30.
That's all I have.
Okay, agenda planning. We actually talked about a lot of stuff tonight that needs to find its way onto this agenda. So the next meeting is September 8th, Tuesday, September 8th. So we've got the Clean Ohio, the Glass Farm Clean Ohio grant. Mm-hmm. Proposal. Do we know of any legislation? We've got two second readings of the ordinance, as we heard today, the Antioch. Let's see. We'll have the consent.
We were talking about having a one sentence vision statement, and then
because it's actually looking like right now we don't have a very full agenda, so let's pull some things in there.
Right. Well, there's also I do want that public art policy thing to be discussed and decided on.
Draft ordinance.
And we have the draft ordinances. And I know, Karen, you had mentioned at a prior meeting, like coming up with some kind of system for doing those. I don't know if we can do a consent agenda, but I mean, because honestly, we've decided everything about the language, and it's really just a matter of plugging in the specifics that's already there.
Well, who's doing that? Are you doing?
I'm doing each one, and then, you know, the commissions will review their own before.
So then let's see if we can. I mean, maybe put it together, see what it looks like, and talk to Chris about whether we can do that as a consent agenda.
Okay.
There are Planning Commission text amendments from the Monday meeting that we'll probably be ready for the 8th as well.
Okay. So we have those. If anybody thinks of anything else, then so we've got. So the police discussion, let's talk about the ACE Task Force. Let's talk about when we're going to schedule that. Because we've got, we're starting to get into budget. Do we want it? Are we ready to talk about that? Can we get?
How about if at our next meeting we talk about how we want it to be? I mean, I made a suggestion of what it would be that we haven't talked about.
Okay, so. ACE Task Force process?
Yes.
Okay. And that, you know, definitely Chief needs to have input to that, and then we can, you know, because I expect there might be special guests or something involved in that, so. Mm-hmm. And that could even potentially be a special meeting because of that. So then September 21 is the work session with Wayne Cannon about the RCAP.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then we've got budget stuff for all of the next meetings, and then December, the special meeting on November 17th about the water plant to interview the water plant finalists, and we need to just kind of add a note to ourselves for December 21 that we've got to do those three resolutions for the levy.
We also need to get a placeholder in there. It shouldn't take long, but to get the ordinance passed for the House Bill 5 changes to the income tax.
Okay, that can probably be done as an emergency. It
could, although I don't think it would.
Okay, it needs to be.
You can just go with Judy and put that in the normal sequence of events. We should be fine.
And there was
What was the other thing that I was just thinking about? I will figure it out. Number seven. Okay, so if anybody thinks of anything else, we're having our agenda planning meeting on Thursday. So
right.
Try to let us know by then if
I just have anything. I wrote a letter to the Cleveland City Council about fully including transgender people in their non-discrimination code. And so I'd like to get council's permission to modify the letter that was on the table as a general letter from council encouraging the full inclusion of transgender people in the code.
Do I have council's
blessing? As opposed to just it being from you or?
Yeah, as opposed, this would be for a September meeting.
Okay.
Yeah.
Although, I know you can change it, but I liked the fact that it was very personal.
Mm-hmm.
So as long as you can retain that.
Oh, you want me to leave the personal stuff in?
I don't know. What did you all think?
Yeah, I didn't have a
problem. Okay, I'll just reword it so that it's clear that that's
that we approve.
I can do that.
Yeah. I liked it. I thought it was very. I thought it was very effective.
Do we have the swearing in of Melissa on the?
Oh, swearing in of Melissa on the 8th. Swearing.
Okay,
at
and yes,
Melissa,
and I was.
I did not say at.
Because I have the PC, the Planning Commission meeting on the 31st, I was thinking I had one more opportunity to write the Wilberforce letter before the end of this month, but I think it's still fine if I get it done by our meeting on the 8th and approved. I apologize. I was just not thinking about that, so I will have that letter.
I think it actually, I'll double check. I believe they need it by the 4th.
They need it by the 4th?
Yes,
oh, crap.
But you've already approved the writing of the letter.
Right.
And I think as long as you bring that letter post writing it so that everyone can say,
okay.
Fabulous job.
Great.
That you've covered your bases.
Okay,
The other thing we need to work in as just in future agenda items is Patty's review.
Yes.
And Brian is working on a schedule. Brian and
Lori
are working on that. So. Okay, good meeting, guys. Hey. Long meeting, but good. Motion.
Will we adjourn?
Second.
All those in favor, signify.
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.